It's been nearly a week since the University of Delaware relieved Dave Brock of his head coaching duties, and today it's time to get back to football. This afternoon, the Blue Hens host the 24th-ranked Stony Brook Seawolves for the first time in school history. You're listening to 94.7 WDSD-FM. I'm Scott Klatskin in the Value Days broadcast booth presented by Shell. Alongside Matt Janis and on-site producer Mike Diodati, reporting on the sideline is former All-CAA Bluehead Michael Atanase. It's been a long and difficult week for the Blue Hens players and staff, but now it's Saturday. It's time to play some football, and no matter who is on the sideline, Delaware needs to win a football game.
They do, and they need to find a way to finish these games. The last couple of weeks, they've had opportunities at key conference wins, and they've let them slip through their fingers. Maine, an absolutely devastating close after West Hills had a heroic performance to fumble the football, have it returned for a touchdown in the game's closing minute when you were looking like you were going to get yourself in position to get a last-second victory. And then, of course, last week, an 11-point lead, just over 10 minutes left, driving to put the game away. The interception that turns things. Defense can't get off the field for the next 10 minutes. Two touchdowns, a surprise onside kick recovery, and then a pick six to close things out. It has been one of those seasons where, in many ways, you almost wish you could just put your head in the sand and have it end. But there's a lot of football remaining. And as Jalen Randolph just said in that intro a moment ago, these guys understand that despite everything that's happening around them, there is the chance to win out and go to the playoffs. There's a chance to end up with a winning record. There's a chance just to enjoy the game of football, enjoy playing with your teammates and family, and finish strong. So much still at stake for these guys, and they got to put blinders on it and just concentrate on the game that they love.
It is the first meeting between these two teams. Stony Brook, a fourth-year member of the CAA, but somehow the schedule makers didn't want to see these two teams meet until this season. So no history between these two teams. Delaware chance to go 1-0 against Stony Brook. It is a windy, gusty, cold day after a week that felt like summertime in Newark. Let's head down to the third member of our crew, Michael Atanase, on the field. What's it feeling like down there, Mike?
Guys, it's feeling like a hurricane. It's windy. You feel a little drizzle here and there. There's an overcast, a couple clouds hanging over. But guys, this is the weather that Delaware's offense loves. It's going to be a rushing battle between Stony Brook and UD. Both teams loving to keep the ball on the ground. We'll see a lot of running in the early goings of this game.
All right, thank you, Mike. Appreciate that. From down on the sideline, we'll be back with Mike throughout the ball game today. This football game will start in just a little bit with Delaware wearing their home blue uniforms with the yellow pants, blue helmets. Stony Brook coming out with the red pants, white jerseys, red helmets on the field. Let's get you the starters brought to you by National 5-10 on Main Street in Newark. First, for the offense of Stony Brook, their quarterback, Joe Carbone, only a sophomore. 52% of his passes have been completed. Just one touchdown, five interceptions on the season this year. Their running back, Stacey Bettle, a captain, an All-CAA performer two seasons ago, injured last year, but eight touchdowns on the year. Wide receiver, Tim Keith and Ray Bolden, two very solid receivers. Bolden, a junior. Tim Keith, a six-year junior. The tight end is Dennis Lestrange, and the fullback is Cal Daniels. From left to right on the line, Paris, Garrick, White, Zimmerman, and Miller for Delaware defensively. Nassib Woodson, Nichols, Kitchen across the defensive line. Jackson, Bell, Reeder. Matt Janis telling us earlier that the linebackers have to have a big game today, and he picked Anthony Jackson as a player to watch. Michael Atanase looking at Charles Bell for the same thing. Malcolm Brown is here. Adderley are the corners. Adderley had 10 tackles solo last week. And Ray Jones, Ryan Torza are the safeties. Offensively for Delaware, Wes Hills looks to be good to go to start this one. That's a good sign for Hills, who's averaging 10.2 yards per carry, a first down per carry this season for Wes Hills. Joe Walker is a starting quarterback. At wide receiver, Deontay Cherry is suspended for an internal team matter. And we have Vinny Papale, who's injured this week and indefinitely with a knee injury. So we know we'll see Jamie Jarman out there. We'll get you the starters as they appear on the field. Charles Scarf and Brandon Whaley, perhaps a two tight end set.
Has won the toss, and they will receive.
And you can hear the officiating crew letting us know that Stony Brook won the toss. They'll receive, so Delaware will have the defense out on the field to start this game. Trump, Lewis, Kern, Robinson, and Bozic across the offensive line. Defensively for Stony Brook, defensive end Humphrey Anu, the nose tackle Josh Valentin, the defensive tackle Usman Kamara, the linebackers Haggard, McGinty, Lawless, and Beverett, the corners Peart and Reed Sigurd, and Cooper and Woods are your safeties. The coaching matchup, Chuck Priori in his 11th season with Stony Brook, and for the first time, Dennis Dotton Carter on the sideline as the head man for the Blue Hens.
And Scott, Delaware electing to take the wind in this opening quarter. So, I mean, there's a gusting, blustery conditions that Mike was alluding to earlier. It is sustained winds about 20 to 25 miles an hour. They're calling for gusts north of 35 miles an hour. We talked about during the pregame show there were points where the goalposts were actually vacillating back and forth. That's how hard the wind is blowing. We saw the kickoff guys for Delaware working on squibs and all kinds of different things when going into the wind. But in the importance of getting off to a good start, the Hens choosing to take the wind here in this opening quarter. So Stony Brook's offense will have to operate into that gust. I'd be very surprised if they could do anything throwing the football going away from the Bob Carpenter Center today at all.
Sherman Alston is back to return for Stony Brook. Jake Roth, who's been a heck of an addition this year on the kicking game, is ready to kick this one away. Jake Roth, 11 touchbacks on the season and an average yard line start of the 26-yard line. So he's got it teed up. Ball's going to fall off the tee a couple times, I'm sure. So it has already once. We'll see if it can stay up there again without having anybody have to hold it.
You get two tries, but you almost feel like this is an effort in futility, don't you, the way the wind's blowing right now? If it stays up on its own, there's got to be some kind of a magic behind Delaware today. Even our crowd bikes bouncing around up here in the booth. It's so windy.
It is a windy day here at Delaware Stadium. Ball's on the tee. We'll see if it stays up. Jake Roth runs up, and it stayed on the tee. We are underway, and he boots it, as he usually does, towards the back of the end zone. Sherman Alston will take a knee, and Stony Brook's offense will come out to begin this ball game. That was incredible in itself that it stayed up on the tee for the first kick.
You know, the stadium today, obviously only about half full. The conditions, not helping matters. The 2-4 record factoring into it as well. But the Hens are going to try to bring their own energy today. That was one of the big focuses of the coaching staff. Make sure everybody's up and is fully emotionally invested in this football game. They went through an awful lot this week, but you know, football's a game of emotion, and Delaware was confident they'd be able to handle theirs.
Stacy Bettle is the single back as Stony Brook comes out on the field to start. Joe Carbone under center. Mike White is the center, and they'll start on their own 25-yard line. First and 10, first play of the game as Dennis Lestrange goes in motion, retraces to the left side, and as we thought they would, they give it to Bettle, and he busts to the outside of the 30, cuts it at the 35, still driving his legs, and gang tackled at the 36, still driving at the 37. It took forever to bring him down as Bell kind of slipped off of him. Jackson and Reeder combined for the stop, but if that's a sign as what we can see from Stacy Bettle, that's a worry for the Delaware defense.
I think you're going to have to focus more on tackling rather than trying to tackle the football. It looked like the Hens were trying to strip the ball free before they had the tackle secure, something we have seen a couple of times from the UD defense this season.
So first down on the first play of the game for Stacy Bettle, a 13-yard gain for the junior from William Floyd High School and transfer from UMass. They'll go right back to the well. Bettle right side this time, and no hole, nowhere to go. Maybe a foot gained on first down for Bettle that time, and it was Blaine Woodson amongst others in on the tackle.
I mean, these are two teams that are very similar offensive mindsets. They want to run the football. They want to establish it early. They can't afford to be in third down and long, and that's the key for both of these defenses. Success in early downs to get them in unfavorable situations late in possessions.
Looks like Carbone going to go as shotgun form this time. To the left side will be Bettle. Three wide receivers, two to the right side on second down and 9 from the Stony Brook 39. First pass play, and Carbone to the outside. It's caught by the fullback. He makes a move at the 40 up to the 46-yard line, and that's a nice run after catch by Cal Daniels, the sophomore, his third catch of the season.
Yeah, I thought Ray Jones just kind of got himself off balance there a little bit, and he lost his angle, and as a result, was a little off balance trying to recover. Fullback, big strong guy, just able to stiff arm him into the ground. You don't see Buck get stiff armed by that very often, but then again, you don't see fullbacks catching the ball on the exterior all that often either.
Jordan Gowan's in for the first time. He's in on third down as it's third down and two from the Stony Brook 46-yard line. Shotgun form for Carbone. Two wide receivers to the left, fullback to the left as well, and they'll give it to the running back Gowan's, and he bursts for a first down into Delaware territory at the 46-yard line. So he goes from 146 to the other 46-yard line before Ryan Torza makes the tackle, and another first down for Stony Brook, their second of the opening drive.
All right, that's a killer, that second down play if you're Delaware, because it allowed him to still run downhill, straight up the middle, and Bilal Nichols just got pushed off the middle of the field and left a huge hole there, right side of the O-line.
Gowan's coming off a 108-yard rushing performance last game, a career high of 21 attempts as well. First and 10 at the Delaware 46. In motion goes Tim Keith on the sweep, but a penalty as it started.
Full start, number 55 of the offense, 5 yards. Still first down.
That's the left guard Armani Garrick with the first penalty of the game. And it goes against Stony Brook.
Well, almost feel like that was a bad break for Delaware. It looked like the Hens had that pretty well stiffed out. Man coverage, motion man running with the receiver. But they had two linebackers that looked like they were going to be in pretty good position to set the edge. They're running that to the strong side of the formation. And the Hens were in good position. That was almost a bad break. Granted, they go backwards 5 yards.
See what happens on first down and 15. Ray Bolden jumping in the air, screaming at his quarterback, and they run the fake sweep this time. Give it to Gowan's up the gut. Troy Reeder's right there to stop him at the line of scrimmage. Not having it that time as a transfer from Penn State.
Well, I like what the Hens did there. I mean, press coverage on the edge, man-to-man, one safety back at Ray Jones. Kind of play the numbers game, flood the box, and on top of that, you also want to play press when you're going this direction. I don't see Stony Brook being able to throw the ball vertically down the field into a 25, 30-mile-an-hour wind. It's not the bread and butter of their offense as it is, but when you add to it the conditions, you'd have to like your opportunity to be able to stop them, so you gamble a little bit more and you try to play the numbers game to shut down this potent running attack.
We see Grant Roberts check in as Blaine Woodson to the sideline on second down and 15. Ball on the 49, Stony Brook territory. Four wide receivers, two to both sides. Empty backfield for Joe Carbone. The quarterback gets the snap. The sophomore is looking. Pressured, climbs the pocket. Now he's going to run at the 45. 40, spinning, and enough for the first down. A great run by Joe Carbone. Middle of the field was wide open. He took advantage, got to the Delaware 35, and converted on what was second and 15.
Well, they spread Delaware out, and yeah, it's man coverage. Nobody accounting for the quarterback. Charles Bell realized it, but it just took him too long to get back up the field, and that's a killer if you're the Hens.
We'll see Bettle back in as Gowan's got hurt earlier in this drive. Cal Daniels is the fullback. I form as Lestrange goes in motion, the tight end. Pressure coming from Jackson. It gets picked up to the outside. Bettle nowhere to go, and Charles Bell with a tackle for a loss. He got help from behind by Anthony Jackson. Nassib set the edge well for the Hens, and that's a good defensive play.
Set the edge and got penetration, so forced him to stop and change direction in the backfield, and then just a great downhill play that time by Charles Bell, finishing a big hit and wasn't going to let him sneak away this time.
Nichols will check out as Woodson comes back in, joining Grant Roberts as a defensive tackle. It's on second down and 13. Ball on the 38-yard line of Delaware. 10:44, first quarter, first drive of the game. Two wide receivers to the left. Offset eye. Carbone throwing on the slant. It's caught at the 28-yard line. It's caught by Ray Bolden. Tackle made by Troy Reeder. So they pick up a big chunk on second down, making it third and manageable. Three to go.
Getting smoked on second down. It's really costing them to third down and shorts. They go press coverage on the outside. You got to make sure you don't give up inside position, because slant is the one way. If you can get a free release off the line of scrimmage going into this wind, that you can have some success throwing the football. And Malcolm Brown just got beat inside.
Full house for Stony Brook on third down and three. Three running backs next to Carbone is in shotgun form. One wide receiver to both sides. And on the option, or the QB choice, they give it to Stacy Bettle, and Troy Reeder's there for a tackle for loss. Great job. You know, Troy having a heck of a game. We needed to see something big from the linebackers today. And Troy Reeder so far, and Charles Bell having a good start. It's fourth down and six.
Yeah, they're going to go for it, though, because you're too close to punt the football. You're too far to kick a field goal under regular circumstances, certainly with the wind. And that's why that's such a big play by Reeder, to be able to go get him in the backfield the way he did, making it a fourth down and long here.
Their kicker, Premshlaw Popek, just one of four on the season kicking the field goal, so they don't have confidence in him. It'll be three wide receivers to the left, five in total. Carbonin shotgun on fourth and six. He floats one, and that one's intercepted by Malcolm Brown at the five-yard line. He's running at the 10, has a blocker at the 15, stiff arm and brought down at the 18-yard line. Malcolm Brown with his second interception of the season.
Well, it helps in terms of energy if you're Delaware. Unfortunately, probably rather he had just knocked that football down and you'd end up with better field position, but taking it away from Stony Brook, most importantly, you stop the possession and you get it back, and Malcolm Brown almost was able to sneak away and end up with a big play, but you'll take it, you get yourself off the field. The only problem is Stony Brook was able to kill almost 6 minutes going into the wind. Your offense has got to take advantage here with the wind at its back in this spot when the defense will have to respect a little bit more space against you.
9:06 on the clock as Delaware gets the football for the first time, and keep an eye on some wide receivers. Looks like Owen Tyler is going to get the start, Jamie Jarman as well. And in motion goes Brandon Whaley to start this drive from the Hens' 19-yard line, and Walker's going to throw. It's caught by Brandon Whaley, and he's got some room at the 30, a first down to the 38-yard line. Brandon Whaley on the first play of the game gets 19 yards and a first down for Delaware.
Well, Whaley goes in motion late there, right to left, and then just sneaks out. Just a quick high percentage throw for Joe Walker, get him some confidence, and that's what we're talking about. First down throws, the opportunity to try to loosen that defense up, especially important when going with the wind at your back here in this opening quarter.
So that gets the football out to the 38-yard line, Delaware territory, offset eye. In motion goes Whaley again. Joe Walker is under center. And they'll pitch it this time. Wes Hills, the running back, cutting, hit hard, still on his feet. And as he gets to the 39-yard line, picked up about a yard after first contact, would have been a loss. And Wes Hills still has not been tackled behind the line of scrimmage this season.
And that was a pretty good effort just to get back to the line of scrimmage and get a positive gain out of that, because it was a sea of bodies. You're on a toss sweep to the right, and you had about four white shirts creating pretty much a wall against him on the outside, but Wes Hills with that little quick spin move just to find his way forward to fall ahead of the line of scrimmage.
No score, 8 minutes, first quarter, second down and 9 for Delaware. Single back is Wes Hills. Joe Walker going to throw. He pumps. He finds his target. Tyler with a first down catch into Stony Brook territory at the 49, and right now, Delaware rolling offensively, a 12-yard pickup after a 20-yard pickup on the first passing play by Joe Walker, and it's Owen Tyler's third catch of the year.
Great sign there by Walker, because they're trying to throw that quick to the outside, and the defense dropped right into his passing lane, so he does not pull the trigger, make the mistake, waits on it, allows Tyler to clear into the second window, and then delivers an absolute bullet through a tight window. Very accurate throw by Walker, but good poise not to just throw it right away when the coverage was there. It would have been a turnover.
Jefferson is in. He's split out to the right side like a wide receiver in a wide receiver position. Wes Hills is the running back, and they'll give it to him running left. He's tripped up at around the 45, dives forward to the 44-yard line, and Noah McGinty in on the stop. That's his 31st tackle of the season. Great to see Wes Hills back. You know, we were told that he was day-to-day, and possibly that was a decoy effort. Who knows? But he practiced during the week, and at one point was looking like he might not be able to go, but he is at times, and certainly up for discussion, the top running back in FCS football.
He's a difference maker. I mean, there's no way to describe it, but I mean, he can make things happen almost single-handedly.
6:46 first quarter, no score, trips to the right side. Joe Walker awaits the shotgun snap, bobbles it. Now he has to throw, does so with some poise, finds Charles Scarf for a first down pickup to the 36-yard line. Joe Walker bobbled the snap, and then the play was a QB read, and he kept the football because of the bobble and still stepped into a throw to Charles Scarf. An impressive start for Joe Walker.
I love what the Hens are doing here. Stony Brook is determined to try to stop the run. A ton of bodies up near the line of scrimmage. So throw early. Get yourself some confidence going to the passing game. Get a little balance, and maybe that'll loosen things up front. And Walker looks good in the early go. Good as he's looked all year.
A double tight end set for Delaware. As they give it to Wes Hills, bouncing to the outside at the 30. Makes the move, a spin inside the 30. Down at the 23-yard line. The tackle made by Shane Lawless, the team's leading tackler, and he was all that Stony Brook had left.
That was fantastic. Another spin by Hills. He's become kind of a whirling dervish back there. The speed to get to the outside and then just spinning back against the grain. And that's Wes Hills in a nutshell right there. Just the quickness. He's just kind of running along with the defense, and you think he's going even and moving laterally, but he's working his way up the field the entire time. And before you know it, he's got the angle on the defender, and it's a 13-yard gain when it looked like it was going to be 5 or 6.
Seventh play coming up with this drive already. 58 yards on the drive, and Joe Walker on first down. Gives it to Wes Hills. He fumbles the football, and it looks like he might have got back on top of it. No, Stony Brook recovers the fumble from Wes Hills with 5:34 left in the first, ending what was a 7-play drive.
Fumble on the play recovered by...
And it looks like we'll take a timeout as Stony Brook's offense will come back on the field. That looked very familiar to Blue Hens fans as you look back at the last home game against Maine. We'll take a timeout. Your PNC Bank timeout score with 5:34 remaining in the first quarter. Stony Brook nothing, Hens nothing as well.
Bird exclusion pass.
Little details. Truly a game of inches. Small things people don't see. It's about putting yourself in the best position. It starts here. The work isn't flashy, it's not glamorous, but it's necessary. Because after all, the future is now.
Hello.
Nice to meet you.
Welcome, welcome. Today I'm going to show you the all-new 2016 Chevy Cruze and ask you what you think. But here's the catch. You can only answer in emojis. What emoji would you use to describe the design?
I think it's sexy.
It has available built-in 4G LTE Wi-Fi.
Rock on, that's excellent. We got Wi-Fi.
This car gets an EPA estimated 40 miles per gallon highway.
This car is like a unicorn. It's magical.
For anyone, Electronics powers the broadcast on 94.7 WDSD, and they do so much to ensure the quality sound, but they're also a major part of the local community. For anyone, Electronics owner Joe Dombrowski volunteers his time for great causes, including the Special Olympics Delaware. They have their Reindeer 5K run and romp coming up December 2nd. And BL is always a part of the famous Polar Bear Plunge, but this season, Joe has also volunteered to help train the Special Olympics soccer team, and now Joe has to do it because it's on the air. He will willingly, I'm sure, but Brandywine Electronics, we appreciate all that they do for our broadcast. On the first play of the drive after the fumble by Wes Hills, Stony Brook gives it to the running back, Gowans. He picks up maybe a yard, Charles Bell with the tackle.
And just runs straight ahead, and Delaware had all the holes plugged. The linebackers really doing a good job with their fits here in the early going, and they're trying to play a little bit more downhill maybe than what we've seen in weeks past.
Carbone is the quarterback in shotgun form. It's second down and 9, ball at the 29 of Stony Brook territory. And he gets the snap. He'll keep it himself. He had a big run in quarter number 1. Troy Reeder's there to stop him as he gets to the 35-yard line.
Stop by 9, Troy Reeder.
A little zone read that time, and you had the linebacker get to the edge. Remember, we've seen the Hens have some tough times containing that quarterback. He's been beating them to the perimeter and kind of turning the corner for some big gains. They just cheated a little bit too wide. So give him credit. He cut it back towards the middle of the field and set up a third down and short.
It's third down and 3 here in the first quarter. No score. 4:21. Tight trips. Tight end Lestrange goes in motion. Carbone, play action. Throwing. Ball is tipped. John Nassib with the big hands knocks it down. It's fourth down for Stony Brook.
Well, that play was lost from the beginning. Tim Keith and Cal Daniels in a tight receiver bunch on the outside kind of collided, and it threw off the timing of the pattern. Charles Bell was slipping in. He might have jumped that slant, been in position to get the interception, but Nassib did a great job, as he usually does, getting those long arms up, being disruptive, and just taking away the passing lanes for Carbone.
Second pass breakup of the season for John Nassib, and now Mark Nolan on to punt. It is a low kick, and Jarman catches it at around the 22-yard line. Going to try to run, spinning off one. Good coverage by Stony Brook, allowing not much from Jamie Jarman. A 42-yard punt, and nothing on the return for Jamie Jarman. I'm glad he caught it, though. We were watching him in pregame, and he dropped a couple. out there in this windy, gusty conditions. We're going to take another timeout with 4:02 remaining in the first quarter. Your PNC Bank timeout scores. Stony Brook nothing, Delaware nothing as well.
Watch all your college football favorites.
Want more Delaware Athletics content? Click around here on Hens All Access for live games, game highlights, features, and more. And follow your favorite Hens on Twitter for the latest updates.
It's your turn to mix it up at Mickey D's. For a limited time, choose any two. From mouth-watering new picks to tasty classics. McPick 2 for $5. Enjoy the choice.
Rush hour or relax hour, it's your choice. Ride more, save more, do more. Dart, moving forward.
Welcome back to Delaware Stadium with 4:02 remaining in the first quarter and no score. The Hens put together a drive on their first time they had the football, but West Hills fumbled, gave it back to Stony Brook, and now the Hens, after a good defensive effort, get the ball back.
And Delaware taking advantage of the win there on that opening drive. They threw for 40 yards on that initial possession on a few different completions, high percentage throws, trying to loosen up the Stony Brook defense, and then, believe it or not, was your best player with the fumble, West Hills, but you still like what you saw on that initial drive.
Hens will start this drive on their own 23-yard line, trips to the right, and Walker will throw that way. Jamie Jarman with the catch, but no blockers in front. Four white jerseys in the area, including Tyrese Beveren, a two-time defensive player of the week in the CAA. No gain to Jarman, but Jarman's third catch of the season.
Chichi Amachi out there trying to make the block and just kind of got overpowered. I think Amachi's a guy that will grow into being able to do that, but not quite able to push around a big physical defensive backfield like this Stony Brook team has, one of the bigger ones in the league.
Delaware has the football, second and 10 on their own 23-yard line. I form with Yoakum in the ball game as the fullback. Two wide receivers to the left side, and the give is to Wes Hills, looking for some space, and he bumped into his own man, Connor Bozick, at around the 25. Still bounced it to the 31-yard line, making it third down and short for the Hens. Third and two it'll be from the 31.
Is he going to play Pac-Man next? Because he was doing the old-school pinball that time. I mean, he was bouncing off the bodies left and right and changing direction and just always finding a way to get the compass back towards moving north. He has as good a balance as any running back you're going to find in the conference. I know he's had a little bit of a fumbling problem the last couple of games, but, boy, is it just, he's just a special kid.
Offset eye for Delaware on third down and two. First third down of the day for Delaware. Walker will be under center, pointing to his offensive lineman, looking at that Stony Brook defense. The give is to Wes Hills, bounces to the outside on the left at the 40, a first down and more to the 42-yard line. Wes Hills hard to bring down. That's Chris Cooper, the safety, with his 29th tackle of the season. What a run by Wes Hills.
They had power set up to the right side, but Stony Brook tried to flood it and overpower it with bodies, and Hills, with that vision, immediately saw it, changed direction right away, and there was just no one left at home on the backside, and with Hills' speed, no one was going to catch him. If you're Stony Brook, you probably feel good that you just eventually were able to go get him and it didn't turn into a touchdown, because he had some open field there.
Hills is something else. He'll take a breather. Jefferson in as the running back. Double tight end set on first down and 10 from the Delaware 42. They'll go play action. Walker all day. Now is losing time, and he gets hit on the blind side for a sack. It's Allen Singleton, his first sack of the season. He was looking downfield, no one open, and he didn't get right of the football, so a sack for Allen Singleton makes it second down and long.
Well, it's back protect for Delaware, only a two-man route, both going vertically. Amachi on the far side, and then Jarman tried to run a comeback on the near side. Give credit to the safety for Stony Brook. Stayed back, did not bite on the play action. And that's a spot where I think Walker will eventually learn, just tuck and run. He had some space to turn that into a positive game. Instead, now you're behind the sticks.
And Walker last week ran for over 100 yards, so he's a good runner. First quarterback to run for over 100 yards for Delaware since Andy Hall did it in 2003. Now here's Jefferson up the gut on second down and long. Picks up maybe a yard to the 39-yard line. So it's going to be third down and long as we approach 1 minute remaining in a quick first quarter of action.
And now you're in a very tough spot. It'd be interesting to see what Dennis Doc Carter does. One thing that he makes sure that he wants to do here, I would not run the football because you want to make sure if you are forced to punt the ball, you punt the ball with the wind to your back. Or if you run it, get stopped short of the first down, get that punt unit out there as fast as you can because it can be the difference of 20, 25 yards with the way the wind's blowing today. Certainly third and 13, not a high percentage play for any offense, let alone this one.
42 seconds and ticking for Delaware on third down and 13. Play clock at 3. Walker calling for it, gets it. Here's Joe passing. He pumps. At least he wants to pass. Now he runs up the middle of the field for a first down. Joe Walker uses his legs, gets into Stony Brook territory, and converts on third and 13.
Fantastic job. They run everybody down the field, and Walker just does a good job kind of surveying his options. Last resort to run the football. He wants to throw it there, find the pocket a little bit. Solid started to collapse from the edge, but saw all kinds of open space middle of the field. Had to make one guy miss to pick up the first down, and he did with a great cut once he got to about midfield.
10 seconds left in the first quarter. We'll see if Delaware does get this play off. Actually, they'll need to because game clock and play clock are the same. So Walker going to roll to his right side, caught by Scarf. He cuts it at the 40 and dragged out of bounds at the 38-yard line. Close to a first down for Delaware, but the Hens moving on their second possession of the game. That'll bring us to second quarter football. We'll take the timeout. Your PNC Bank timeout score, no score. Second quarter coming up.
International Brotherhood of Electrical Workers, Local 313, and its signatory contractors.
How are you doing?
Thanks for coming. Today you're going to choose a mobile office to drive to a remote work site.
Okay.
You can choose this Chevy Silverado that offers built-in 4G LTE Wi-Fi, or you can choose this Ford F-150 that doesn't offer Wi-Fi. But to make up for it, we added a trailer, a satellite antenna, and Dolores.
Hey, fellas.
Technology's a little behind in here.
Now, the Silverado offers built-in Wi-Fi with a connection that's stronger than your smartphone.
Slick.
So which one do you want?
I'd pick the Chevy.
Silverado.
It leaves Ford in the dust.
You just can't beat it.
And a goal! It's Delgado with his second.
Saudades in the Newark Shopping Center is not just a restaurant, it's a Brazilian dining experience. If you have not experienced it for yourself yet, what are you waiting for? I was amazed at the meat selections, the decor, the hospitality, and the amount of delicious food at Churrascaria Saudades. Their gaucho chefs roast the finest cuts of meat over open fire and serve these skewered cuts tableside, plus a gourmet salad bar, signature cocktails, and a dessert cart. You've got to try this place for yourself. You'll love the experience, as I know I did. Churrascaria Saudades, Newark Shopping Center. Do yourself a favor and visit eatsteaks.com. Second quarter about to open up. Delaware driving now against Stony Brook. They look good on their first drive of the game. It was stopped by a fumble by West Hills. But again, Matt, looking good on their second possession.
And they've just been a tad more aggressive with the play call, more balanced. I mean, they threw for 50 yards in that opening quarter. If you'd have told me in a game that has the weather conditions this one does so far that they were going to throw for 50 yards in the opening period, I'd have said you're nuts. Now, things will change a little bit here as you're going into the wind in the second quarter. It'll be much more difficult to try to operate through the air, but here's where you start to go downhill.
Second down and one. In motion goes Jarman. He stands next to Joe Walker. Jarman will get the football, running to the left side, similar to the 9-yard touchdown he had a week ago. Shoulder into a fender at the 32-yard line.
That's a heck of a play by Jamie Jarman. They try, you know, if Delaware wasn't so stacked at running back, you could try him at back because he lowered his shoulder and just bulldozed his way for an extra 3 yards there.
Check that. It is second down now and 6. It'll go trips to the left side as Walker throws to Jarman low. They try to go fast, maybe too fast for their own good as Jarman dropped the football.
I think what happened there was the official was really slow getting the football spotted, and at that point you probably should have just pulled back and gotten organized because Stony Brook was able to get there. Sean Devine was outraged by the officials there not being able to get that football placed. And they were just trying to go a quick pass and get Stony Brook out of whack. And it was everything was off there. The offensive line didn't jump right away as the ball was snapped. Walker kind of hesitated, almost thinking maybe there was a penalty. And then he threw it low on a quick outside pass to Jarman.
We'll see Randolph for the first try and trips to the right side on third down and five. And Walker designed keep and fooled nobody on the Stony Brook defense. Gets back to the line of scrimmage by diving to do so. John Haggard was there first for Stony Brook. It's fourth down and five.
I'm not really sure what you do here. You're right at the edge of where it's too close to punt the football. It's a tough spot to try to pick up 6 yards, but I think you got to keep your offense out there. And Will Lewis just got beat that time. We haven't said that very much this year. Lewis has been so solid. He just could not get to his guy on the outside on that sweep. He's pulling. And Stony Brook was able to get up the field as a result.
The senior from Jacksonville, Will Lewis, left guard, 32nd career game, 28th start. Now fourth down and six. Delaware this season, 4 of 6 on fourth down. And Stony Brook bringing some pressure. A timeout going to be taken by the Delaware Blue Hens with 14:01 remaining.
Delaware
in the second quarter. As you heard, their first timeout. They just didn't like what that was looking like, Matt.
And Devine came sprinting up the sideline to take the timeout there and then was upset at his team. They have been a little slow getting lined up, and it almost seemed as though not everybody was on the same page. We saw it as they tried to go hurry up after the first down play. Guys were, of course, not aided by the officials being slow spotting the football, but there was some confusion getting set up. And then that time, they had the receivers in the wrong spot. They had to go move them physically to the other side of the formation. And then when you had the front looking, Sean Devine just did not like the look and wanted no part of snapping that football. This big play, I think it makes a lot of sense to get everybody on the same page. You can get the first down here. All of a sudden, you're in scoring position, and you get the feeling that eight possessions are going to be a premium in this game. The way the clock has been burned through in this opening quarter, and then points certainly are going to be very valuable as well. This is not going to be a high-scoring game.
After the timeout taken by Delaware, back on the field with Randolph as the running back to the left of Joe Walker. Fourth down and six. Ball in the Stony Brook 33-yard line. No score in the second quarter of action. Stony Brook showing some pressure. Walker in the pocket, hit as he throws, ball comes loose, and it's scooped up by Stony Brook. It's going to be a touchdown return for Jaheim Woods, the captain, and Stony Brook up 6-0.
Touchdown, Stony Brook.
Joe Walker's got to step up that time. He stayed in the backside of the pocket, and as he cocked the arm to let it go, the hit came in his back, and the ball went up in the air, but it was before the arm touchdown started to go forward. They have replay here in effect that they can take a look, but to the naked eye, looked pretty clear that the arm was getting set to start to come forward, but it was still being cocked back by Joe Walker, and that's what left the football so prone and unbelievable. I mean, Delaware really has controlled the game.
Touchdown is under further review.
And we'll look at it here. Maybe the naked eye is wrong, but I know we both had the same indication. It looked like that ball came out. We get our first look up on the big board. He comes up. It looks like an empty hand coming forward.
Yeah, what my hesitation was, and what you're kind of seeing on the board here, Matt, and we'll describe it to you, is Joe Walker's arm went all the way through as if he was throwing the pass, but the ball was hit before he continued that motion. So it was deceptive to the naked eye. Watching it again, though, because Joe Walker's arm went all the way forward, there was the potential for it to be an incomplete pass. But when we watch it again, it looks like the ball was knocked out when the throwing motion began and not necessarily when it was ending. So that should be a touchdown for Jaheim Woods.
And that's the thing they always tell the replay officials to look for, that as the arm comes forward, is anything in the hand? The empty hand thing, they call it. And it just looked like the ball was already up in the air as the arm started to come forward. And that's why it went up in the air the way it did, because he was still cocking back to get into throwing position. And his arm come forward as he's getting hit. I think the momentum of the football would have had to been carried forward. Instead, it was carried lateral.
After further review, the ruling of a fumble returned for a touchdown has been confirmed. Touchdown.
Hurts if you're Delaware, though, because you played such a solid 16 minutes. Your defense has been fantastic. Offense has moved the ball and showed balance, and yet you're still down.
They have found every way to give touchdowns to the defense over the past 3 weeks of football. A fumble return for a touchdown twice, and an interception return for a touchdown a week ago against William & Mary. The extra point is through, and your PNC Bank timeout score. Stony Brook 7, Delaware nothing, 13:48, second quarter.
Star Health at the University of Delaware offers comprehensive clinical health and wellness services.
They end 2015 with a road victory over Elon.
Our season ended at 255. At 256, a new season began. But we can't just talk about it. We've got to be about it. On the field, no one's spot is guaranteed. And in here, excuses don't matter. I'm going to work harder and longer than I ever have. Check your feelings at the door, because the bar has been raised.
Control is the Blue Hens Radio Business of the Week, but they have been a proud supporter of local community for years and years, always sponsoring our broadcasts of high school football, local teams, local little leagues, because they are a local company. For 40 years, Royal Pest has been locally owned and operated. Support the company that supports our community, Royal Pest, providing planet-friendly residential and commercial pest control. Visit royalpest.com. Back here in action, 13:48 remaining in quarter number two, and Joe Walker fumbles the football. A 55-yard return by Jaheim Woods makes the score that way. A tough break for Delaware as they were driving once again.
And they've looked solid offensively except for two critical plays. Now, they broke down a little bit at the tail end of that possession. Some miscommunication that cost them formationally getting lined up in the right spot, but they were still in position inside the 35 with a fourth down and manageable, and Walker has the ball knocked out of his hands, and suddenly from in position to score to the other team putting points on the board. It's just what we saw at the end of that William & Mary game last week.
I mean, you look at Delaware, they've got 85 total yards of offense on two drives, 35 on the ground, 50 through the air, which is balanced and more yards than Stony Brook. But you're right, here somehow Delaware finds themselves down, and that has been really the story of this season, at least recently, over the last four losses. Ball comes off the tee as Alex Lekansky, the kickoff specialist, will kick it away for the first time. Left to right, Delaware turning back to the student section as they change directions on the second quarter switch. We're just into the second quarter. And running up to get it is going to be Ray Jones at the 20, running at the 30-yard line. And down he goes. Check that out. It was Malcolm Brown at the 35-yard line. He was the up man. So good field position to start this drive for Delaware.
Well, we had been talking to the coaching staff about trying to get more out of the return game, and what we see a lot of teams do against Delaware is try that short high kick. And so what Delaware did there was Jones and Brown both were lined up short. They had Owen Tyler back deep. And so they get a guy with athleticism, the ball in a pretty good spot, and Malcolm Brown very nearly was able to break that one and take it to the house.
Wes Hill's back in as the running back on first and 10 for the Delaware 34-yard line. Three wide receivers, including Scarf, in the slot to the right side. 13:43, second quarter, and it'll be Hills running, trying to find some room on the right side. Not much there. Pickup of about three for Wes Hills on first down.
But it's amazing. You're right. There wasn't much there, but he still turned it into a three-and-a-half, almost four-yard game just with pure quickness. I mean, there was no hole. Good job by Joe Walker to finish the fake on the back end of that quarterback keeper. The Hens going into the wind now. It's going to be tougher to throw the football, so you got to get more creative to try to keep the defense honest.
Sam Kamara made the tackle, the true freshman. Second down and six from the 38 of Delaware. And shotgun goes Joe Walker. Again, it'll be Hills this time to the left side. Cuts it at the 40-yard line. Contact there as he gets to the 42. It'll be third down and about 3 yards for Delaware.
If you're Stony Brook, it's got to be frustrating. I mean, Bever at that time sets the edge, and it looks like they've got it bottled up, and he just makes a little jump cut and explodes four and ends up with a pretty decent game out of the deal. But if you're Stony Brook, you can live with giving Wes Hills four. You can't allow him to break free for 15 and 20. So better job that time forcing him back to the help, to the pursuit in the center of the field.
And he's had four on back-to-back runs, making it third down and two from the Delaware 42-yard line. He's got 40 yards on the day, does Wes Hills, and a chance to add to it. Ball comes loose, flies in the air, and it's recovered by Delaware at midfield. Owen Tyler right place, right time, as he jumped on it. And it'll be a first down for Delaware as that ball flew about 5 yards forward from the contact.
Wes Hills comes off the field. He got hammered. Remember, he's still playing with that elbow brace where he dislocated the elbow in the game against Lafayette. And he looked in some discomfort as he took a helmet right on the football and on that elbow. The Hens very fortunate to get that one back. And we'll keep an eye on Hills and see how long he's out for.
Second fumble of the game for Wes Hills. This time recovered by Delaware, and it's first and 10 with Randolph in the ball game for the Delaware 49. Walker going to keep it to the outside, 45, 40 of Stony Brook, and tackled out of bounds by Chris Cooper, the junior from Mount Vernon. Nice run by Joe Walker, and enough for the first down.
Well designed by Delaware that time. Quarterback counter going back against the flow of the defense, and then you had Scarf, it looked like, on the outside. They just threw a great seal block to clean up the backside. I think it actually might have been Owen Tyler on second look that threw that block and freed Walker up to get to the end.
Tyler having a good day so far as a starter. And now Walker will go under center. First and 10 ball at the Stony Brook 40-yard line. I form as Yoakum is the fullback. They'll give it to Randolph. Randolph starts right, cuts to the middle of the field, and gets tackled at the 39-yard line of Stony Brook. A pickup of maybe a yard and a half on first down. Stony Brook leads 7-0, 11-17 to play second quarter.
Big Steve Robinson out there that time just kind of got shoved and lost his footing, and that was the reason why Randolph just kind of hit a brick wall near the line of scrimmage. Dalen's big, strong guy and able to move the pile forward a little bit, but you never want to see an offensive lineman on the ground at the point of impact there. And Robinson just completely lost his footing. He got drilled by two D linemen.
That was the first carry of the day for Jalen Randolph. Second down and 8 ball at the Stony Brook 38-yard line. And Walker will drop back. He's looking right, throws in that direction to Jamie Jarman, who makes his second catch of the day. Trying to dive for the first down marker. I think he's going to be a couple inches shy at around the 30-yard line. They'll officially make it the 31. So it'll be third down and about a yard for Delaware.
Maybe even foot with the way they spot that football. This is really short and absolutely two downs to try to get it. Great toughness here shown mentally by Delaware. The immediate bounce back. Got to find a way to put points on the board, though, here on this drive.
Joe Walker is 6 of 7 for 57 yards. Good first half of football for the quarterback. Third down and 1. Single back is Randolph. They don't need him as Walker plows ahead and moves the sticks as he kept it himself and kept the drive going.
I like what Walker did there. He didn't just take the snap and immediately move forward. The nose tackle was trying to crush the center and kind of collapse it, thinking that a sneak would come. Walker took it, hesitated for an instant, let the line get a little push, and then found a crevice, and he ended up sneaking for, what, 2.5, 3 yards there.
Got up to the 28-yard line of Stony Brook. Three wide receivers. Jarman on the left side. Walker in shotgun as Randolph is the back, and Randolph will get the football. Patiently waiting to pick his hole, and he does so, getting to the 20-yard line outside left, pushed out by Beverett. But that's a patient veteran run by Jalen Randolph.
Yeah, what he did was he helped Brody Kern get in position to throw the block at a linebacker on a run blitz, and Brody Kern had an awful lot of ground to cover to get over there, and he threw a key block on Noah McGinty, but the reason he was able to do it was because Randolph allowed him the time to get out there and set it up. And that's just Jalen Randolph having a good feel for how much time he had before turning it up the field.
Randolph is the quarterback, and now Jefferson in as a single back on second down and 1. Thomas Jefferson avoids a tackle in the backfield, gets to the line of scrimmage, nothing more. It'll be third down and a yard to go.
But they are just sending McGinty full speed downhill that time. Second time he's come in, slipped his way into the backfield. Kern was able to get him on the last one. This time Jefferson had to make a miss. And really good job, though, by Delaware to avoid the loss there. And now you still have two plays here to keep it on the ground and try to pick up the first down.
Delaware 4 of 5 on third down converting today. And they'll try to make that 5 of 6 on the offset eye with Owen Tyler in the backfield as the fullback. Walker under center. Jefferson is the running back in motion. Jamie Jarman again. Walker to keep it himself, and again gets well more than the yard needed for the first down. So this drive continues in the red zone. 8:42. Second quarter action, Hens down 7-0.
What a response for the Hens. I mean, kind of a microcosm of this season for this team. They just They keep putting themselves in position. They keep finding adversity. I mean, earlier in the week, they have their head coach fired. Today, they've moved the ball, really controlled the game statistically, and a fumble takes away one scoring opportunity. Another fumble gives points to Stony Brook, and they're right back at it, knocking on the door again.
Scarf split out wide with Emerson. I form for Delaware on first and 10 in the red zone at the 16. It's Jefferson. Contact in the backfield. Down he goes. Tackle made
20, Thomas Jefferson on the carry.
By Jordan Scarborough, the defensive tackle.
Scarborough just blew Brody Kern back into the backfield. Kern made a great block a moment ago. Can't win every play. At that time, as Kern was trying to get to the outside, great job by the D tackle. Slipped the gap. If they're going to pull, you've got to beat them and kind of try to sliver your way in between. Well, Scarborough did that and then some. He didn't necessarily sliver. He made his presence felt.
Sure did. No yards on three carries for Jefferson thus far. Two wide receivers to the right on second down 11. In motion goes Chichi Amachi, and they'll fake the give to him on the sweep. Now Thomas Jefferson with some space up the middle, gets to the 12-yard line. It'll be third down coming up for Delaware.
Somewhere Tubby Raymond is smiling, isn't he? I mean, you have a little wing T look there as you fake one direction, crisscross back the other on the counter. Almost slipped that to the second level. The way it was set up, I thought Jefferson had a chance to score. Great shoestring tackle to save the touchdown on the backside by the Stony Brook defense, but it gets it to a third and manageable. I don't think two down territory, though, here, unless you get it into a fourth and a yard or maybe two. You're within field goal range, and you need something positive coming out of this drive.
Whaley coming out, and Delaware have to call a timeout as the play clock was going down to three, so it'll be third down.
Timeout, Delaware. Their second time out of the half.
Well, that clock got down in a hurry, didn't it?
Sure did. It was racing down. Hens weren't ready to call the play that they wanted. 6:50 remaining in the second quarter. Big play coming up, though, on third down. The Hens right now with a 12-play, 54-yard drive, and they've been able to put together these drives each time they've had the football. The first two, though, ended with fumbles recovered by the opposite team, and now Delaware in the best position of the day, though, to put some points on the board.
And that's why I think you're looking at a third down play where you got to get six. You're not looking to try to get three or four, put yourself in better position on fourth down. I think you have to find something positive out of this drive. You would love to get a touchdown here. You're certainly looking to keep things going, but I don't think Sean Devine's in a spot right now where you're telling them, hey, you got two to get six here, so call it accordingly. Could be wrong, who knows? You're with an interim head coach. You've been a very aggressive mindset and team all season long, and you would think it would even get more aggressive in the situation that you find yourselves. But I just think it's so important mentally for this group to be rewarded with points after the drive they've put together.
After the timeout, third down and six from the Stony Brook 12-yard line. I formation rolling out on the play action is Walker. He pumps, has some room to run if he went to the outside, but he cut it back instead. Still on his feet, though, and he finds a way to convert the first down. At the 5-yard line, he picked it up. What an athletic move at the last moment to move the sticks by Joe Walker.
But made himself right there. I'm not sure why he didn't just throw the ball to Tyler. He had the step on the defense. I think he picks up the first down. He just had to kind of shoot it forward. But then as he tucked it to run, he was in a world of hurt, stops on a dime, cuts back, reverses his field. Phenomenal effort by Walker.
I formation, Jefferson is the back from the 5-yard line. It's first and goal to go. Walker talking to his offensive lineman. 6:19 to play, second quarter. Jefferson to the right side, nowhere to go, and he might have lost a yard.
Thomas Jefferson on the carry.
Great play call, though, by Sean Devine. Their boot on the goal line there that way, and you completely fooled him. You sucked in the linebacker. You had Tyler out in front. You had Walker with space on the edge. Take advantage of your strengths.
Randolph will check in. Randolph on the season, 6 touchdowns. Second down and 6. Ball on the 6. 5:50 to play. Second quarter of action. No points for Delaware. This is as close as they've been to getting some. They trail 7-0. This is the 15th play of the drive coming up. I form. Yoakum is the fullback. Randolph behind him. Ball on the far side hash. Walker going to lob it up for Scarf. Scarf tips it to himself, and pass interference is going to be called on the incompletion back of the end zone.
They make it easy on the official when you pull the receiver's shoulder pads out from underneath his jersey. And Scarf, still with that big frame, was almost able to fight him off and make the catch. All right, I beg your pardon.
Pass interference, number 31 of the defense. Ball be placed at the 2-yard line, first down.
Whaley, it was Charles Scarf, yeah. I beg your pardon, trying to fight his way. as well. He was awful excited and giving him some credit on that far side, but it was Scarf. He's huge. He's got that big frame. Walker throws the ball to the back pylon, exactly where the ball is supposed to be, and the undersized corner has to grab to avoid the touchdown.
Delaware 13 rushing touchdowns in the red zone. Split backs with Randolph and Hills in the game. It's the give to Randolph, and they won't get in this time. And he gets back to the line of scrimmage. Maybe lost one to the three. Good pursuit by Trayvon Reed-Segur, who was there first. Also, John Haggard there. The linebacker's having a good day.
John Haggard just slipped his way into the backfield, and they have got to find a way to cut down on this penetration, because as much success as they've had, the one recurring theme that we have seen throughout has been a white jersey in the Delaware backfield. Their backs have made some nice plays to avoid disastrous plays, but it's happened too often.
Second and goal from the three, and motion goes Yoakum from right to left. It'll be Walker on the rollout, looking to pass, and he juked himself out, trips at the 6-yard line with Haggard on him in pursuit.
It's a heck of a play by Haggard, because they were trying to slip Jalen Randolph into the flat, and it looked like it was going to come wide open. As Haggard's going to chase Joe Walker, he got just enough of Randolph to get him off balance, and Randolph fell down. So now it's all on Walker. Haggard still able to get out there and run with him, and Walker has to try for the full shimmy, the full little shake move, and got tackled by the 6-yard line as he tripped himself.
17th play of this drive coming up. It'll be Walker in shotgun form from the 6-yard line. Spreading things out to the left, Scarf to the right. On third and six from the six, back end zone, lob to Scarf, and Scarf wanted pass interference again, didn't get it this time, as Marvin Hart was there in defense. Incomplete pass, it's fourth down.
Yeah, there was some contact, but I think that time a lot of the contact was initiated by Scarf. And I think that's why the officials did not throw the flag Delaware's direction. The ball not quite thrown as far to the back pylon as it needed to. Scarf had his hand on Hart first. Then Hart grabs the shoulder pad of Scarf. He could have easily got that call, but because Scarf puts his hand on there first, it kind of extends it. I think the official just sees it as hand play and lets it go.
23-yard field goal attempt coming up for Rango. First field goal attempt of the season, under 40 yards. And this one is up and through. Delaware on the board. They trail 7-3 with 3:56 left in quarter number two. That's your PNC Bank timeout score on 94.7 WDSD.
There are over 3,000 lawyers.
Little details. Truly a game of inches. Small things people don't see. It's about putting yourself in the best position. It starts here. The work isn't flashy, it's not glamorous, but it's necessary. Because after all, the future is now.
Hello.
Nice to meet you.
Welcome, welcome. Today I'm going to show you the all-new 2016 Chevy Cruze and ask you what you think. But here's the catch. You can only answer in emojis. What emoji would you use to describe the design?
I think it's sexy.
It has available built-in 4G LTE Wi-Fi.
Rock on, that's excellent. We got Wi-Fi.
This car gets an EPA estimated 40 miles per gallon highway.
This car is like a unicorn. It's magical.
WDSD. Welcome back to Delaware Stadium on a cold, windy day here in Newark. I'm Scott Klatskin next to Matt Janis, Michael Attenrasse on the sideline. Delaware goes 18 plays, but only 3 points to show for it as they couldn't get it done from first and goal from the 2-yard line. It ends up with a 23-yard field goal from Frank Rango, but in what is a low-scoring football game and what will probably be throughout, points important, and at least they got three on that drive, which went 60 yards.
Now remember, the Hens will get the football to start the second half. Very important drive here, final 4 minutes of this second quarter. Stony Brook going here with the wind at their back. More importantly, Delaware's got a kickoff into the wind, so it'll be interesting to see where Stony Brook gets possession here. You'd have to think this will be some sort of a line drive, maybe get the ball on the ground and hope your coverage team can go down, because if they put it airborne, I don't know how far he'll be able to get this ball.
Jake Roth with assistance, skies one. It gets caught in the wind. A fair catch is made at the 32-yard line by Julius Wingate. That one just got caught in the wind, and came about 5 yards backwards at around the 25.
You know, that's not a bad idea, actually, by Delaware. Put it up and force an up man to make a play because it's a live football. It's not a punt. He can't let it go. That's a heck of a catch by Wingate. The presence to call for the fair catch and then kind of made it over the shoulder at a three-quarters angle. Hens got fortunate they didn't get a 15-yarder. There was some contact, and you're not allowed to touch the guy after he makes a fair catch.
3:56 on the second quarter clock is what it is for Stony Brook as they come out first and 10 on their own 33-yard line. Tim Keith, the 6-year man in motion. There's some movement. That's going to be the second false start on Stony Brook this afternoon. We'll hear it.
False start, number 62 of the offense, 5 yards, still first down.
It's Mason Zimmerman. Armani Garrick, the left guard, got called for it earlier today. Right guard Mason Zimmerman moves him back 5 yards.
Why is the clock? Boy, the officials wind the clock there. They should not have it. Yeah, they're going to fix that because he hadn't run a play from scrimmage. The officials have not been on the same page over the course. We saw a couple of delays in getting the ball spotted. We've seen some confusion from them, and the Hens thought that they should have gotten the pass interference call. It's been an awkward day for the Zebras so far.
It has. 3:56 on the clock as they put it back where it needs to be. First and 15 after the false start to open the drive for Stony Brook. Tim Keith in motion from left to right this time as Carbone awaits the shotgun snap. Here's the sophomore quarterback. Tosses it to the right side to Bettle at the 35. Room to run down the sideline at the 50, at the 40, at the 30. A stiff arm. Down he goes at the 25-yard line. Knocked out officially at the 22. They'll mark it. And Stacy Bettle with a huge play of 50 yards to open up the drive against Delaware.
Boy, Justin Watson really frustrated because he thought he got held by the receiver down the field. That's either the longest engaged edge block I've seen or a clear hold, one or the other. Would have been a 15, 20-yard gain even without the hold, but Watson, he's the contain guy. It's his responsibility to get over there to the sideline, and he was being held on for dear life.
Bettle had just 8 yards rushing prior to that 50-yard pickup. Now first and 10 for Stony Brook, 2 yards away from the red zone. Again, it's Bettle. This time up the middle, absorbs some contact at the line of scrimmage, gets up to the 18-yard line. Tenny Adewusi on the tackle after a 4-yard gain.
Got to find a way to hold him to 3 here. I mean, you're going to the locker room down by 11 in a game where outside of that one play and the 2 turnovers, you really controlled. And you could be down by 2 scores if the defense doesn't stiffen here. This is a big red zone spot.
Delaware's had the football for 19 minutes and 19 seconds, just 7:26 for Stony Brook. Get the score, 7-3. Stony Brook on top and now in the red zone. Carbone on play action, throwing high, nearly brought in by Ray Bolden with his right hand as he reached for it, could not haul it down, and it falls incomplete. Third down coming up for Stony Brook.
Nice pattern. Outside step and then got inside position that time on Teddy Adewusi. Adewusi tried to recover and at least get back involved in the play. But a little bit of a high throw that time for Carbone, and he had himself a touchdown on the post.
Carbone 2 of 5 today. He's just 17 yards and an interception. Walker on the other side of things for Delaware. 6 of 8, 57 yards. Third down and 6 in the red zone at the 18. 2 wide receivers to the left side and a tight end there as well. Bolden to the outside right. They're looking left and a pass is caught at the 15-yard line. Ray Jones is there to make the stop on Connor Davis, the tight end, preventing first down yardage. No run after catch. And it'll be 4th down and 3 for Stony Brook.
Looks like they're going to go for it. We talked about they have no confidence in their kicking game whatsoever, to the point where the coach said, hey, I'm not going to blame it on the kicker. It's not all on him. And then the next sentence proceeded to say, he's got to make kicks, though. He's not making enough kicks. Not sure how that's not blaming it on the kicker, but he's showing his lack of faith in him now.
He's just 1 of 4 on the season, Premshaw Popek. So they'll go for it on 4th down and 3. Hens looking to come up huge here. Carbone keeps himself to the left side, and I don't think he's going to get it. He is stuffed, and it's going to be a turnover on downs in the red zone for the Hens.
Troy Reeder staying at home on the backside, doing his job, forcing him inside, and then Charles Bell came in to help out as he tried to sneak away from Reeder. Although Reeder, a tough guy to sneak away from. That's a great job by Reeder, keeping his leverage, and Nassib came to get involved in the play as well. That's a great team effort, but a fantastic individual effort to really make it possible by Troy Reeder.
Great stop by Delaware, just their 4th stop in the red zone this season. And Delaware's offense gets back on the field. This drive will start with a minute 53 remaining in the first half. Hens down by four from their own 14.
Now, if you're Delaware, it's all about one first down here and get to the locker room. If you break a big one, great, but you just want to get a first down and get to the locker room.
Joe Walker gives it to Jalen Randolph. Flag on the play, marks it dead.
That's not going to make life easy.
Full start, number 88 of the offense. Half the distance of the goal. 5 yards, still first down.
And that's a newcomer, Chichi Amachi, who has not played a whole lot of football. Reminder to our listeners, Deontay Cherry suspended one game for an internal team matter, so he's not playing. Vinny Papali has a knee injury, so he's not playing. We've seen Amachi. Jarman has two catches, more from Charles Scarf and Owen Tyler, but that's a freshman mistake that time.
Remember, Papali got hurt trying to make the tackle on that pick six at the end of the William & Mary game.
First down and 15 from Delaware's own 9-yard line. It'll be Randolph to the right side. Nothing doing. He gets a yard up to the 10.
Stony Brook's got to call timeout here.
Stony Brook with three timeouts to use. And
timeout, Stony Brook. Their first time out of the half.
Well, if you're wondering how windy it is, you can hear it every time the ref turns his crowd mic off.
As Stony Brook calls a timeout, I want to take time to let you know that you can take it from me. J. Michaels Painting is the place to go for all your painting needs. They received the Super Service Award for Angie's List and have over 25 years experience. They are the number one rated residential painting company in Northern Delaware, and I know firsthand as to why. Their professional painters came into my home and left it looking fresh, clean, and new. We absolutely love the work that J. Michaels did and would use them again for interior painting, exterior painting, and even trim carpentry. Give them a try. Visit jmichaelspainting.com. 1:43 remaining in what has been an odd first half of football, and you kind of described it. Delaware has the football for 19 minutes and 29 seconds. Their offense has looked good. Stony Brook has the ball for under 9 minutes in the first half, but the turnovers that have led to scores continues to be something that hurts Delaware, and they find themselves down by four right now at their own 11-yard line on second and 13.
Second down, 13.
Here's Walker back to pass. He throws to Jarman, nearly intercepted. That was way off the mark for Jarman on the screen pass. Way too high for Jarman to collect. And a dangerous play as it went off the right hand of Jarman, and his tip sent it in the direction of a Stony Brook defender.
Way too high, way too hard, yeah. Too. And you put those two things combined together, and you're right, near disaster. If that ball just bounces a little bit higher in the air, it's a pick six for Stony Brook. It's a shame, too, because that's pretty well blocked. I don't think it goes for a first down, but I think it gets 7-8 yards. Instead, Stony Brook gets to keep the timeout, and you're staring at a punt into a very heavy wind with a punter standing inside his own end zone.
It's third and 13 for Delaware. Randolph is the back from the 11-yard line of the Hens. Randolph trying to pick up a block as he gets to the 15-yard line, called the 16 as he goes Randolph down there, close to the original line of scrimmage. And a timeout can be taken.
Timeout, Stony Brook, their second timeout of the half.
By Stony Brook. Fourth down and 8 coming up. We'll see Will Stevenson for the very first time.
Well, the Hens really need to find a way to get a first down here. We'll have to see what Stevenson can do, because on the kickoff, strong leg, and the ball literally, I mean, you described it perfectly. It got to the 25, 26-yard line, and then the wind said, no, that's too far. And it must have blown it back a good solid 5 yards, where Wingate had to make an awkward fair catch. I think you got to try to find a line drive towards maybe the sideline and hope to get a roll, because you put this one center of the field. We were watching some warm-up punts that were going, 15, 20 yards in the air, and that's about it. It is tough conditions. The only good news is the wind settled down ever so slightly here at the moment. You wish you could hurry up and just snap it right now.
After the timeout taken by Stony Brook, 1:33 of football left in the first half, and Stony Brook up 7-3. Will Stevenson awaits the snap from Tim Sheridan. On fourth down and 8. It's a good snap. Stevenson gets a good punt off to Stony Brook territory at the 47, taken by Alston. He lost a couple of yards on the return. Nasir Adderley was there. A 37-yard punt by Will Stevenson. All things considered, the Hens will take it on that punt.
Oh, great. I mean, spiral center of the field, but had a little hang time as much as he could have given. And then I'm not sure why that wasn't a catch and get up the field. Instead, the east-west cost him a yard or two. He went backwards on that return. Fantastic tackle turned in by Adderley, who's really turned into a good special teams player.
Adderley, defensively, 10 tackles last week, led the team, all solo stops by Nasir Adderley. So now one timeout left for the Seawolves, 1:25 to play in the first half. They have a 7-3 lead. And they'll start from their own 46-yard line with Jordan Gowans, the sophomore, as the running back trips to the right side. And Gowans will get the carry. Armin Ware.
Fumble.
Stripped him, and it's picked up by the Hens. Running is Charles Bell at the 40. Picks up a block to the 30. At the 20-yard line, pushed out of bounds. And the takeaway for the Hens with a minute 13 remaining in the first half.
Charles Bell, Johnny, on the spot, and Troy Reeder threw a huge block. It didn't look like he was going anywhere. The strip, though, comes from Armin Ware. Ware getting that big paw on the football. Bell doing a good job to scoop it up. Reeder showing off what he used to do at Sally's when he was a big-time offensive player, threw a huge block, and Bell's got some speed there. He broke a tackle, and Delaware, how about this, in position. Could the Hens be leading at the half? This game has had all types of swings in momentum.
1 minute, 13 seconds remain in the second quarter. Hens down 7-3 after the takeaway. Jefferson is the back. Walker in shotgun form. Scarf in the slot to the left. They'll pump. Looking for Scarf. End zone. Up. Grabbed it. Knocked out last moment. Jaheim Woods with the pass breakup at the very last second. Prevents what would have been a touchdown for the tight end.
Well, that's the throw Walker's got, though, isn't it? I mean, that is tight coverage. There's only one spot where he could put that, where Scarf can use his big frame to try to go get it. Nice throw, and then a great effort by Scarf. Got position, went high in the air, was trying to make sure he got that foot down, and as he was securing the catch, fantastic job by Woods to get his fingertips on the ball.
Jaheim Woods, the captain, a senior. One of their best players making the defensive stop. Second down and 10 now from the 20. Walker looking for Scarf. This time it was on Scarf. He was in the end zone and it slipped right through his hands. That would have been six. He knows it too.
Well, we've talked about Joe Walker a little erratic with the accuracy from time to time, but when you give him a target, when he gets a little separation, he can make some throws. And that was not an easy catch for Scarf, but one he has to find a way to make. He's got both hands on that football, and he knew it, hands on head, as soon as it slipped out of his hands.
Hands down 7-3, and now suddenly third down and 10 from the 20-yard line of Stony Brook. Jefferson is the running back. He'll get the carry. Stutter step as he approaches the 15-yard line. Still pushing ahead. The pile still moving down to the 12. And now it'll be fourth down and two with 47 and ticking.
So you want to be an interim head coach, Scott? Do you take the points here and go down by one? I think you do at this point, because even if you get this first down, what do you look at in terms of time left? Now, Stony Brook has a man got down, which stops the clock at 34. That helps Dennis Dotton Carter in terms of giving him options. But you got to look at it here from a situation of, if you get the first down, how many more snaps are you going to get at the end zone? You only have one timeout remaining, so you would think one or two, because you get this clock stopped at 34 seconds. This tough spot. Honestly, I'd probably take the points. Fourth and two is far from a sure thing. But again, as we kind of touched on earlier, what do you have to lose?
Yeah, you're nothing two to lose
four,
right now.
You're at home, interim head coach. Do you gamble and try to put six and take a lead into the locker room? The reason I think I would go points, get the ball to start the second half. You've played better. You want to make sure you take momentum into the locker room with you. But Dennis Dotton Carter saying, forget that. I'm going for it here. I'm putting the chips on into the pile, and let's see what we can do.
And you know what? Why not? For all the reasons you had mentioned, interim head coach, game number one as interim head coach, Dennis Dotton Carter going to send his offense onto the field in the red zone at the 12-yard line on fourth down and two. 34 seconds left, down 7-3 here in the second quarter.
But the Hens are lined up. They're giving the look to Stony Brook. And the coaching staff is begging them to get into the huddle, because they just gave their formation a look. The coaching staff is going to get a chance to see that, because the officials are still over with Dennis Dotton Carter discussing something with him.
Play clock has not started yet. 34 seconds remaining. It looked like they were ready to snap the football, because you're right, they did come out and show the formation. Chuck Priori now talking to the officials on the other side. Officiant crews on both sidelines talking to both head coaches. as there's a delay here. The Newark Urgent Care injury break originally was for Trayvon Reed-Segura, the junior cornerback. But this is a long break.
Well, Priori's upset. It's an injury in the final minute. I would think that Stony Brook would be forced to take a timeout there in that spot. They came and had a long conversation with Dotton Carter. Then they ran over to the other sideline, and it's an even longer conversation with the Stony Brook head coach.
Dotton Carter, hands on hips as he stands at the 25-yard line, kind of looking across the field at Chuck Priori. See if we hear something from the officiating crew as they're communicating with each other still. It looks like the referee wants to speak.
Now he's going back to Dotton Carter.
This is odd at this point.
I don't think they know what the rule is right here in this spot.
How do we get here? Stony Brook got the football back with about a minute 34 remaining. They fumbled on the very first play. Charles Bell took it down to the 20-yard line. A couple incomplete passes and then an 8-yard gain on third down. Makes it fourth down and two. Delaware, it looked like they were going to be down heading into locker room. Now a chance to take the lead heading into the locker room, but they've got to get 2 yards to continue this drive as the officials continue to talk with Dennis Dotton Carter.
The discussion here is it an injury that forces a timeout for Stony Brook, or are you going to start the clock when it's wound in for play? And it doesn't seem like they're entirely sure which way it should go. If they're going to start the clock as it's blown in for play, the Hens need to be lined up and ready to go. And now they're going back to the Stony Brook sideline. This is ridiculous.
Ridiculous is a good word. And now we're hearing some boos from the Delaware Stadium crowd, rightfully so. Get it together. Officials need to do so.
In the NFL, this would be a timeout charged to Stony Brook. I don't know. I thought that was the rule in college as well.
The officials certainly don't know the rule either, so they're with you, man. And now it looks like we're getting close. From the 12-yard line, fourth down and two, and we hear the whistle, play clock starts. Delaware comes out. They need two to extend the drive.
The clock is
bunch
stopped.
Left. Jefferson is the running back. Walker in shotgun form. It's Walker to the outside. Cuts it, runs into Tyler, and they're not going to get it. Stony Brook stops Delaware on fourth down, and Delaware can't get points on the board to end the half.
The linebacker stayed at home on the backside, and then on top of it, as Walker tried to cut back, he ran into Tyler. And that took away any opportunity for him to be elusive and make somebody miss. And that's the problem with being aggressive. Everybody likes going for it until you don't get it, and then the deflation going into the locker room. The good news is, though, still a one-possession game, and you do get the ball to start the second half.
Yeah, we'll get the ball to start the second half. Stony Brook going to take a knee to send it to halftime. Before we head into the locker room, remember Michael Attanase will be with interim head coach Dennis Dotton Carter. That interview presented by Rufo Associates. Visit RufoLaw.com as Coach Carter makes his way over to Mike quickly. Matt Janis, an interesting first half of football, that's for sure. Stony Brook leads 7-3.
Turnovers killed both teams. The difference is Stony Brook was able to turn one into a touchdown on the defensive side, but really a relatively even first half. Hens controlled time of possession, showed some balance, some things to build on there. Just got to find a way to put more points on the board.
Michael Attanase awaiting Dennis Dotton Carter, who is taking his time getting to the end zone where Michael Attanase stands. But four turnovers in that first half. You're absolutely right. Two for both teams. Obviously, the fumble returned for the touchdown by Stony Brook's Jaheim Woods. The only touchdown in this first half. Mike is with Dennis Dotton Carter, so we'll send it down to Mike on the field.
Coach, very odd first half. We've dominated the first two quarters in statistics, but not in score. Tell me about that.
Yeah, I mean, we just had some things not go our way. You know, they got into our area because they had a nice big run on a scramble, kid up the middle. We got out of our rush lanes up there. We got to do a better job with the rush. Then we got to do a better job conversion. We're in the zone coverage there. We got our eyes on the quarterback. We got to see that then come back down. Again, we just had some things not go our way. We had a couple drops, you know, and you know, Joe's looking pretty good. He's putting the ball. He had one in the dirt. We tried to go hurry up. We would have had an opportunity right there to go get a first down and keep that thing going. Frank kicked when we needed him to, and then obviously we missed an opportunity right there, right in the end of the half.
Coach,
except for one big run, we've done a good job on defense, holding Stony Brook's always seemingly good rush offense. Is something we're doing something different, or are we doing something the same?
No, we're not doing anything different. You know, the guys came out, they prepared, they know the opponent. They did a really, really good job all week, Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday. They knew that Stony Brook was going to come run the football. They know Stony Brook's caliber of athletes. They came up prepared and ready to go.
All right, thank you, Coach.
Thanks.
All right, thanks to Michael Anarouse on the sideline. We're going to take timeout. We come back. Matt Janus has a scoreboard update for you as we begin the Blue Hens halftime report, presented by the International Brotherhood of Electrical Workers, Local 313, and its local contractors. 7-3 at the break. Stony Brook leads here on 94.7 WDSD.
When it comes to picking
from the beautiful Delaware coastline to the busy streets of Wilmington, it's easy to see that even within our 96 miles, Delaware has a wide variety of people. That's why when you're looking for great rates on insurance, you should trust the local agent. Ann Sharp from your GEICO local office knows Delaware. And that's why when you need insurance, you can trust Ann and her team of professionals. Call Ann Sharp at your GEICO local office Delaware today for a quote.
Welcome into this edition of Under the Lights, driven by Chevy. I'm Scott Klatskin here with interim head coach Dennis Dotton Carter. The show has changed. As earlier in this week, it was announced that Coach Brock, after 3.5 seasons, was relieved of his duties as head coach of the Blue Hens. Now, everyone that has been around this Delaware program for some time over the last 3.5 seasons knows that Coach Brock was a great guy, a great family man. He brought in great students to this university and a lot of talented players. He checked off every box that needed to be checked off in what you're looking for as a head coach. The only box that maybe was left blank was compiling the amount of wins necessary at this university, and unfortunately, he was let go earlier in the week. Coach, your task with taking over the Hens at this point in the season, and we'll talk football, we'll talk X's and O's, but first, I know Coach Brock meant a whole lot to you.
Yeah, Coach Brock was an amazing person, human being. The thing that made me gravitate to him the most was just how strongly he felt about the players. You know, he, without a doubt, made them his first priority. He wanted them to have the best possible experience that they could have here at the University of Delaware. He felt that the University of Delaware was a first-class institution. He thought that we could do a great job here, and that was his number one job, and I think he did a great job with it. The players loved him. They love him still. You know, as I've said before, they feel indebted to him. We all are indebted to him for everything he's done, whether it be just hiring us here at the University of Delaware. And on top of that, there are things that no one's going to know about that he's done for us as a staff. You know, so I am extremely, I am in his debt, and I am extremely, thoughtful of him. I want to do a great job. I want to make sure that, we obviously win games. But I want to keep intact all the right things that he's done.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, in the bottom line business of college football, coaches are going to be hired, coaches are going to be fired all the time. When it happens inside of a season, though, it can be difficult to make that transition for the coaches, for the staff, and certainly for the players. What's your message to the players this week leading up to the game on Saturday?
My message to the players is going to be simple. Things have changed. You know, we have constantly, since we've gotten here, talked about being together. You know, together we will has been our team mantra. And I'm not going to change that. You know, we need to stay together. It didn't matter whether we were undefeated or where we are right now, you know, at 2-4. It doesn't matter what the circumstance is. You got to play the next play. And the only way you're going to win anything that you do is together. You know, it's a team sport, one of the biggest team sports around, 11 guys all at one time. And you need the guys who aren't on the field to be with you. You know, everyone needs to be dialed in. Everyone needs to be committed. And I think this group of young men is a resilient group. I have been thoroughly impressed at how well they've dealt with this. We are certainly moving forward. The goal is to beat Stony Brook on Saturday. They're going to give us a huge test. We know that. We are prepared to go out and prepare for a really, really, really good football team. And we are prepared to go out and do that together.
All right. Well, I appreciate you doing this show. I'm sure this is the first time that you've been able to sit still for quite some time, certainly since Sunday and your conversation with Chrissy. Describe the whirlwind that has been your week so far.
I think the biggest thing is just the volume of information now that I'm getting. You know, it's a whirlwind is a great way to describe it. You know, I'm just getting all the knowledge that Coach Brock had, and you got to deal with it. You know, it's nonstop. There are so many different venues you got to put yourself in. You know, when people know academics and you know football. There's also athletic training. There's also strength and conditioning. You know, and then there's so many behind the scenes things that either involve the players or don't involve the players that you got to take care of. You know, and everyone kind of knows that the head coach has more responsibilities, but you never really know until you're there. So I mean, that's been the biggest thing. Again, the volume of information, and then obviously trying to balance my football duties. You know, I certainly have not had the opportunity to do as much as I've been doing. But I mean, like I said before, we have a great staff, an unbelievable staff, defensively and offensively. I put my faith in those guys. And we'll move forward from there.
Well, let's talk about some of those duties that you had as defensive line coach and defensive coordinator. And Coach Brock, not only head coach, but he worked with the quarterbacks as well. He was the quarterback coach. So how will you slide some of the responsibilities throughout the staff?
Yeah, so I mean, it's kind of a tough dynamic, obviously, with Coach Brock coaching the quarterbacks. You lose him, you lose the quarterbacks coach. You promote a guy, now you kind of lose another position. You almost lost two position coaches with one move. But again, Mike Bamonte has done a tremendous job since he's been here. I have full confidence in him. Coach Devine has full confidence in him. Obviously, Coach Devine is he'll oversee the whole operation. But again, Mike has Mike is a very intelligent young man, and the players gravitate to him. The players, they respond to him. So I have faith in him to be able to get the job done. You know, defensively on the defensive line, again, Coach Lott's been here for 2 years. He's been in the system. He knows what we want to do. He's got a great relationship with the players. So I think they'll respond to him as well. Again, he's not going to take over the full duties of the defensive line, but he certainly will help us out.
Well, let's talk some football, because you're coming off of a loss against William & Mary on Saturday on the road, a game in which you led 14-3 against the Tribe at Zabel Stadium. Once that was the score, there was an interception in the red zone, and William & Mary was able to start on their 20, drive 80 yards, 11 plays, an excellent drive. They didn't face a third down until late in that drive. Then the onside kick, and then a 10-play, 54-yard drive to get the lead in the hands of William & Mary, kind of just like that. But with all of that, your defense was on the field for 9 minutes and 59 seconds of game clock, actual time much longer. Do you feel like when you defend against an 80-yard drive, onside kick, and you're right back out there, the defense might have been a little gassed at that point?
Yeah, I wouldn't use the term gassed. And the reason why is because I think we do a really, really good job of rotating the guys through. Mm-hmm. On the defensive line, we're rotating those guys through, constantly. If a play is going longer than five plays, if a drive is going longer than five plays, we're gonna get those guys in and out. And obviously there are personnel substitutions based on down and distance. And I think we do a really, really good job going from drive to drive, substituting in the defensive backfield and at the linebacker level. So I would not say that, gas would not be a term I would use. And I think our team is in really, really good condition as well. Yeah. I never feel like we come off the field, even after an 80-yard drive, even after a 10-play drive, a 15-play drive. I never feel like we come off the field and we're just dead. I don't ever feel like that. I always feel like we're ready to go back on the field, no matter when that time may be. It may be the very next play because of a turnover. It may be in 15 plays because of a great drive. I always feel like we're ready to play the next drive. And at the end of the day, we put it on those guys. They need to get off the field. We need to get off the field. Mm-hmm. We need to make the calls that get us off the field, and we need to make the plays that get us off the field. Every week we take a look at the film, and there's always going to be some plays. You hope not, and you hope this week it won't be the same. But so far, there'll always be plays where you look and say, hey, if we just made this one play, if we beat this one block, if we fit this one gap correctly, we could have gotten off the field. And they know that. They know we've got to get off the field. We certainly don't blame the interception in the end zone. They had to drive 80 yards. And we talk about making offenses earn everything that they get. Clearly, we don't want them to get anything. But if they do get something, we want it to be earned. And we did give up some yards that weren't earned. So, gassed, I would not say that, no. And we certainly know we need to get off the field.
Okay, let's talk about the offense. Because interceptions were thrown against William & Mary, and that's an uncommon trait for this team. The team, going back to last season to start this year, had gone 100 passes without throwing an interception. There was the one in the red zone, and then unfortunately, 2 weeks in a row now, the game kind of ends with a defensive player running back into the end zone. What did you see on those interceptions? Where were the breakdowns?
Well, the first interception, the one in the end zone, that was a coaching error. We shouldn't have called that play. Coach Devine has owned that. He has said, he wished he ran the ball. Obviously, in hindsight, we wish we would have run the ball. But, run game's going well. We made the call. And at the end of the day, you know, we still didn't execute the play correctly. You know, there's always, you know, there was the execution issue. So we can go back and say, you know, we shouldn't have called the play. But if it was a touchdown, we wouldn't be sitting there saying we shouldn't have called that play.
Right.
Exactly. And then, you know, on the second interception, it was a miscommunication between the quarterback and the receiver. That's what it comes down to. It's tough. And that particular play, the coverage they were playing, and you know, that spot on the field, it turns out to be a pick six, you know, and it's unfortunate. We obviously were put in a tough position, but, you know, those miscommunications happen. It could have happened earlier in the game, and we probably wouldn't be talking about it as much right now, but at the point in time that it happened, it's very significant.
Well, a chance to bounce back this week against Stony Brook, and it's good to be home. You'll have back-to-back home games for the first time this season starting on Saturday. So we're going to talk about Stony Brook. First time Delaware will be playing Stony Brook in conference competition. But we'll take a timeout. We come back down and back with Grant Roberts, a guy that you know, I'm sure, very well from the defensive line. So we'll hear from him, and then we'll hear about Stony Brook. You're watching Under the Lights, driven by Chevy.
Welcome.
How you doing?
Thanks for coming. Today you're going to choose a mobile office to drive to a remote work site.
Okay.
You can choose this Chevy Silverado that offers built-in 4G LTE Wi-Fi, or you can choose this Ford F-150 that doesn't offer Wi-Fi. But to make up for it, we added a trailer, a satellite antenna, and Dolores.
Hey, fellas.
Technology's a little behind in here.
Now, the Silverado offers built-in Wi-Fi with a connection that's stronger than your smartphone.
Slick.
So which one do you want?
I'd pick the Chevy.
Silverado.
It leaves Ford in the dust.
It just can't beat it.
Little details, truly a game of inches. Small things people don't see. It's about putting yourself in the best position. It starts here. The work isn't flashy, it's not glamorous, but it's necessary. Because after all, the future is now.
Welcome to another edition of Down and Back. I'm Andrew Wickman, this time alongside Grant Roberts. Grant, we're going to get to know you a little bit better today. How's that sound?
Sounds great.
Cool. All right, first question. What does it mean to wear the blue and gold after being from Delaware?
It means a lot, you know, to be able to be close to home, play for my home university, have my family come out and see me play games. It feels great.
So other than playing for Delaware, what does it mean to be at Delaware on campus?
You know, it's great. I love the university. You know, it's fun. The academic side of it is a big part for me, which is part of the reason why I chose to come here, you know, so it's good.
Cool. So going with that academic side, what has been your favorite class or favorite professor?
I would say Edgar Johnson actually was probably my favorite professor, my intro to sport management class.
Why is that?
He taught the class a lot because sports management is what I want to do. So he taught the class a lot about the ins and outs of the sport industry, and he was a athletic director here, so it was great to learn from him.
All right, so you said sports management is what you want. I saw that you wanted to be a GM. Do you have a particular sport you want to be a GM in? Obviously, football could be favor.
Definitely football, but, you know, if I could work in any sport, I've grown to like a lot of the other sports, especially soccer. I've grown to like soccer a lot more recently. So, you know, any sport really, but a GM definitely for football.
Cool. So any other sports that you play, if you weren't to play football, what would be the other sport?
Other sport, basketball probably.
Yeah?
You know, I'm pretty good.
Nice.
Got a good jump shot.
Oh, yeah. Is that right?
Yeah, pretty good.
All right. So going back up to campus, what has been your favorite memory while being at Delaware?
Probably my first sack.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Here. Against who?
Elon, my red shirt freshman year. You know, it was a great feeling to finally get the first one. Yeah.
That's awesome. And how about up on campus?
Probably the first semester I got over a 3-0. You know, I struggled a little bit at first, but, you know, I was able to pick it up academic-wise.
What were your season goals heading into this season, and do you still have them? Have you changed?
My season goals were just to be a better player, be, you know, better technique-wise, also be a leader on the field, you know, for the younger players, just be all-around better player.
All right, we'll go with a fun question here. What is your guilty pleasure?
I really love, like, gushers and bacon.
Oh, yes.
They're definitely not good for you, but definitely two of my favorite foods.
How about a guilty pleasure song that you listen to before a game or just in general?
Before a game? Self-Control by Frank Ocean is one of the new songs that I've been listening to recently. You know, it's not really a usual hype song before a game, but I definitely listen to it.
All right, if there was a talent show held right now with the whole football team, would you win? Or if not, which one of your teammates would win and with what?
I probably definitely wouldn't win because I don't have a talent. I don't know who will win. Maybe Jethro, since he can juggle, obviously. Thistle is pretty good at singing. He plays the guitar. No, one of those two, definitely not me.
So heading into the second half of the season, what are you guys looking for?
We're just looking to compete hard, you know, come out and win all the games we want to know each week. You know, conference play is coming up, so each game is going to be tough, but we should be able to win every single one of them.
How about you? What are you looking for to do?
I'll just keep producing, you know, keep being a good teammate, keep being a leader, keep being able to, you know, provide leadership for the young guys and, you know, helping the team win.
Awesome. Well, thank you, Grant. We really appreciate getting to know you a little better. For Hens All Access, this has been another Down and Back. I'm Andrew Wickman. We'll see you next time.
They end 2015 with a road victory over Elon.
Our season ended at 255. At 256, a new season began. But we can't just talk about it. We've got to be about it. On the field, no one's spot is guaranteed. And in here, excuses don't matter. I'm going to work harder and longer than I ever have. Check your feelings at the door, because the bar has been raised.
And a goal, it's Delgado with his second.
Delaware 3, 1, 2, 3.
Delaware! Got the shot, and that one's in as well.
Welcome back to Under the Lights, driven by Chevy. Scott Klatskin here with interim head coach Dennis Dotton Carter. And amongst all the things that you've got to do this week and get ready for, number one on the priority list is Stony Brook. The Seawolves come into town with an undefeated 3-0 record in the CAA. They're a top 25 team now. Got in this week, ranked number 24 after a win against Rhode Island. Stony Brook has been a member of the CAA now for four seasons. This is the first time Delaware will be playing Stony Brook in a conference game. Is it odd to be playing a CAA game but not have any, you know, obviously you have video of the team but not any against your team to kind of look at and have experience against?
Yeah, it is odd, you know, especially at this point, you know, when you've been in the same place for multiple years to not have played a team in the entire time. Again, this is our fourth season here. This will be the first time we play them. Mm-hmm. It's absolutely odd. You don't have a frame of reference on how they interact with each other on the field, how you know, how the coaches interact. All those visual things, they help you out during the game, and to be able to draw from that experience moving forward, you know, that's always good. So it is a weird situation, you know, but again, you know, every year we'll end up playing, well, this year we played a team who we hadn't played before in Wake Forest, you know, so it's not out of the realm of normalcy, I guess.
Yeah, but this is a Stony Brook team that is 4-2 on the season. They're 3-0 in conference play. Like I said, a top 25 team. But you look at their offensive numbers. They're 10th in CAA in scoring. They're 11th in total yards, 11th in passing. They're not a high-powered offense, but their record is pretty good, and they find enough to win ball games.
Yeah. I mean, when you talk about their offense, you know, you look at just look at their body of work. They scored 42 points in the number 2 ranked team in the country at Richmond. It was at Stony Brook, you know, so that kind of makes you feel good. It wasn't on the road because it's hard to win on the road. So if they're doing that on the road, they're pretty good, you know. But again, I mean, they've got a great, great team. You know, they are ranked for a reason. You watch them on film; they look like they should be ranked. Offensively, they have a number of skilled players who can, you know, who can beat you, who can create explosive plays. They have an offensive line who's a very, very good offensive line. And they have experienced players too. You know, they've got a group. You know, they have a couple transfers transfers that have come in, mm-hmm. but they've got a group that's been together as well. Like our group has been together. So you know, offensively, we know that they're going to be a force. They're going to try to run the ball. They kind of make their money being physical. They'll throw it if they need to, and you know, they'll be very similar to us. You know, I wouldn't be surprised if the game is over in about 2.5 hours.
Yeah, it's very similar offenses. Stacey Bettle is a guy coming off an injury a season ago. He scored 4 touchdowns in that game you talked about against Richmond, averaging 106 yards per game over the last 4 games. An experienced player, what does he do well?
I mean, he's a shifty back. He's got deceptive speed, meaning when you watch him, he doesn't look like he's running fast, but he's not going to get caught. Mm-hmm. He does a great job reading blocks. And, you know, I think one of the best compliments you can give a back in an offense like that is that he's patient. You know, he does a great job setting up his blocks. And I think, they've got a good coaching staff because all those guys, you know, they really do a good job running the football.
Defensively for Stony Brook, they're 2nd in the CAA in rush defense, a top 15 team in the nation in rush defense. But they haven't faced a offense running the football like Delaware yet? Do you feel like you can still attack them on the ground?
I mean, we're always going to feel like we can attack anybody. You know, in our DNA, we're going to believe that we can run the ball on anybody. We're going to believe we can stop the run against anybody. That's
yellow pants, Stony Brook on the road wearing white jerseys, red pants, red helmets. I'm Scott Klatskin alongside Matt Janis, Michael Anrasse on the sideline. We are ready for second half football on 94.7 WDSD as Alex Lukanski has it held for him at the 35, and he kicks this one away. It's high. Wynn catches it. Running for it at the 28-yard line is Malcolm Brown. He takes it to the 35-yard line, runs into traffic at the 40-yard line. Down he goes at the spot. Anthony Anderson on special teams making the stop. A good field position to start this second half for the Hens. Let's see if the Hens can get some points on the board to open up this second half of football, as they did everything right for the most part on these drives in the first half, but they just couldn't turn it into points because of late turnovers on the drives.
Got to finish drives. That's a big part of the thing. Dennis Dotton Carter talking about that at halftime. Good job there to slip Malcolm Brown up, go catch the football, and made a couple of guys miss, and you're right, fantastic field position.
Wes Hills is the single back. Tight end to the right is Whaley. And it'll be Walker. He's in trouble, racing out of the pocket, trying to get back to the line of scrimmage, and does by diving ahead to the 39-yard line. Good pursuit from the start from Usman Kamara, the junior.
Kamara was in the backfield, and I think what happened there was he gave so much ground to kind of just win the race to the outside, but it just seemed like it was off from the start. If you move Whaley back in motion to the other side, there's somebody there to block the backside linebacker without the motion. He came in pretty much untouched on a play that's designed to go that direction. I think that was a missed motion there at the start of the play.
Ball on the far side has trips to the right side for Walker on second down and 9. Second play of the second half. Play action, throwing to Scarf. Caught, first down. Stony Brook territory at the 45. Second game in a row that Charles Scarf has had three catches on the day.
Well, that was awful close to targeting there. Chris Cooper came in and delivered a big up hit up high on Scarf. Scarf's actually going to have to come off. He didn't look 100% there as he got drilled, but great throw from Joe Walker. Boy, he has been very effective to the center of the field.
Walker this season completing only 43% of his passes today, 7 of 12. That includes a drop by the man who just caught the football, Charles Scarf. First and 10, ball on the Stony Brook 45-yard line. Play action, Walker all day to throw. He pumps, now pocket collapses. A hold is going to be called against Delaware as Walker tries to make something happen. He's stripped of the football, comes out. Stony Brook recovers the football.
I think it got out of bounds.
It was right on the sideline.
Sacked and fumbles the football. Out of bounds.
I don't think.
And it is out of bounds as a call on the field. They can look at it. It's a hold against Delaware, but another fumble by Delaware.
And sometimes as a quarterback, you have to know when to live to fight another down.
The ruling on the field was that the ball was touched while a player was out of bounds, thus making the ball out of bounds. Second down.
That's a break for Delaware, a huge break for Delaware.
You still got to tell us about the penalty. I think he forgot about that.
Holding, number 54, the offense. That penalty's declined, second down.
It was Big John Haggard, who's been a huge thorn in Delaware's side over the course of the day.
Ooh.
And see, he never had possession of it as he rolled over.
They're showing it here at Delaware Stadium, so that was my reaction.
I don't know whether he would have been in full possession, even if he had gathered it clean with the foot in bounds, but once he rolled over, he never secured that football. It bounced away to the sideline. And I think the only reason there was any hesitation from the officials was it was on the Stony Brook sideline, and they were all being lobbied pretty heavily by the coaching staff.
Chuck Priori was on the spot. He almost recovered the football himself. Second down and 14, ball on the 49, still Stony Brook territory, but after the penalty, moved back a bit, and it'll be West Hill's first carry of the second half. He spins off of what would have been a tackle for a loss and gets back to line of scrimmage. Third down and long coming up, 2 minutes into this third quarter.
It's just an offense that is not built to get off schedule, and that four-yard loss, Walker trying to keep the play alive, reversing field and try to break the tackle up and get knocked free. Kind of gets everything off kilter, and now you're in a pretty much a must-throw situation. And the reason why this is an important play, you only get so many opportunities with the wind at your back. And this is one of them, and you got good field position with it. And we're really hoping to be able to put points on the board.
This drive started just 10 yards ago. Good field position as you mentioned. Now third down and 15. Walker looking left. He's going to run with it. Pressure comes. He's stripped. Ball loose. Stony Brook has it. Another fumble by Delaware, and Stony Brook gets the rock.
He's got to feel that pressure and just trying to extend the play, and Walker's down.
Fumble recovered by
I don't know if he got injured on the hit or as he tried to go after the football. Just kind of stayed stable. The pocket finally tried to break free last second, and guess who again? I mean, Haggard is just wearing Delaware out for the backside. Got a big piece of Walker. Had a ball pop free. Walker's got to feel that pressure, be able to step away from it, and he's also got to make sure he's got two hands and a little bit more ball security there.
Matt, that's the fifth fumble of this game for Delaware. They've lost two of them, but that is the fifth fumble. It is not raining here. It is windy, but that should not affect you holding on to the football. You got to be secure, and Walker's being looked at right now. 12:18 remaining. As we're just underway here in the second half, a Newark Urgent Care injury break is Joe Walker being attended to. Looks like they're looking at him up top somewhere, man.
Yeah, the left shoulder, it looks like what Dan Watson is looking at right now, the Delaware athletic trainer, and helping him up. You wonder if that was on the recovery. He got hit and stripped, and then he tried to lunge forward into a pile after
the football. Yeah, he tried to go get it.
And I think that's where the injury came. Hopefully he's all right, because outside of the fumbles, and he does need to make sure that he can get that fixed, he's had arguably his best game as a Blue Hen to this point. He looks confident throwing the football. He's been accurate with the ball, but he's got to just take better care of it right now.
So he'll move to the sideline now, but so will the Delaware offense, as Stony Brook's offense will come onto the field.
Delaware 49-yard line, Christensen Seawolf.
As we see Simaguashuvanu back on the field, even out with injury earlier today. Carbone and shotgun to start the first drive of the third quarter for Stony Brook from the Delaware 49. He's going to throw, pass high, nearly intercepted off the hands of Nasir Adderley, as Tim Keith couldn't get a grip on it.
Well, Keith immediately looked at Ray Bowden. There was some confusion on the route, but that being said, Keith popped open. Just a high throw and one of those high tosses where it gets deflected in the air, gives you an opportunity to try to react to it. Heck of an athletic effort from Adderley, just couldn't get low to cradle it.
It'll be Tim Keith and Ray Bolden on the left side for Carbone, two top receivers on the year. 12-14, third quarter. Carbone goes under center this time, and they'll run play action, rolling out. Carbone has to get rid of it, throws it almost into the stands. That one was so deep. A couple of the freshmen that don't get to dress. Catching the football for Delaware, but good coverage by the Hens that time.
Fantastic coverage. He was throwing it away because he knew the pressure was coming. I don't understand the play call. You're going away from your strength. Perhaps they thought they would catch Delaware by surprise going into the wind with a couple of passes, but it's a run-first offense, very much like Delaware. And now they're in a third and long, which is not a favorable spot for Stony Brook.
Hens showing blitz out of the nickel on third down and 10. From the Hens 49, Bell showing some pressure. Carbone throwing over the middle. It's caught with room to run at the 35, 30. Ray Jones with pressure down the sideline at the 22, 21-yard line. And on third down and 10, Tim Keith makes it happen against man coverage.
Boy, it's just a little shallow cross, and it looked like Simaguashuvanu was running with him. And I'm not sure if he got rubbed off. I think that's what happened. He got rubbed off by the receiver coming across the center of the field, and Guashavano just could not keep up with Keith, who able to pick up a critical first down, and now they're in scoring position.
Yeah, from third down and 10 near midfield, a play later, it's first and 10, a yard away from the red zone. Bedell is the running back, bouncing to the outside, turning the corner at the 10, 5, diving for it.
Coming back.
And it's going to come back as there's a flag on the play. There was no signal whether he got in as the pylon fell, but it's coming back.
Holding, number 76 of the offense, 10 yards, still first down.
Going down the line, Garrick's had a penalty, Zimmerman, and now that was Jackson Miller, the right tackle, holding on the play.
I mean, that wasn't just a hold. That was a clutch, a grab, and a bear hug, all wrapped up into one. And I think that's why the official didn't even buy. I didn't think he wanted to make the effort of raising his hands into the air. It would have been a complete waste. Good job by Cam Kitchen there, getting to the outside and forcing the hole.
They knew that one was coming back. 11:27 and ticking. Stony Brook up 7-3 here in the third quarter. Trips to the left side for Carbone, who's in shotgun form. One wide receiver to the right side and man coverage. Delayed decision made by Carbone on the read. He tried to go right, tackled at the 29-yard line by Charles Bell.
And Bell and Reeder both stayed at home on that backside. That zone read, they've been much more solid against it here over the course of this afternoon. Hens confused here with the bodies coming in and out, but fortunately, Stony Brook confused as well. That was not a clean switch by either group.
Aaron Donaldson and Armin Ware late to come off of the field, but Delaware is set. Now getting set is Stony Brook. Carbone under center. Two tight ends on second down at 18 from the Hens 29-yard line. Here's play action. Carbone rolling to the right side, and he's going to tuck, try to keep it. Brown slows him up. Reeder pushes him out near the original
Joe Carbone on the
start of our marker at the 21.
Nassib got good penetration, forced him to tuck immediately. Then Brown was the second guy over. You mentioned that forced him wide to the sideline, and did a good job just to come in waves and clean it up, and it keeps it a third down and long.
Stony Brook 2 of 5 on third down, 0 of 2 on fourth down. Remember, they have no confidence in their field goal kicker, Premshaw Popek. So it's third and 13 from the Delaware 24. Trips to the left side, empty backfield, 5 wide receivers, 2 to the right. Carbone sets, pressured, throws behind Bolden, who was coming across at the 20, and it falls incomplete. So 4th and 13, 9:59, third quarter.
I don't know what you do here. I mean, you caught out your kicker, so I guess field goal isn't it. But 4th and 13 seems like an awful long way to try to pick it up. But at this point, going into the wind from 40 yards, even though I will say the wind has died down a bit here in the second half. It's only blowing about 20 miles an hour after it was pretty steady over 30 in the first half.
It's 4th down and 13. Delaware in man coverage on 4th and 13, defending at their own 24. Carbone in shotgun. Hens pressuring. Carbone in trouble. He has room to run at the 20, 15, 10. First down for Carbone into the end zone. A 4th down touchdown run from 24 yards out. And the Seawolves go up 10.
Blitz means man coverage. Man coverage means everybody with their backs to the line of scrimmage. And when the blitz doesn't land, Guachavano got knocked down. That left a huge gap in the Delaware defense. And then give credit to Carbone. He makes the decision. Not a lot of wasted movement. Just ran straight ahead. Wasn't trying to duke anybody. Knew where the sticks were. And then lowered his shoulder and fought his way into the end zone.
Popek on for the extra point. He's missed one this year, won't miss that one. 14-3, that's your PNC Bank timeout score, 9:49, third quarter action. We'll be back in a moment.
You know what.
Want more Delaware Athletics content? Click around here on Hens All Access for live games, game highlights, features, and more. And follow your favorite Hens on Twitter for the latest updates.
It's your turn to mix it up at Mickey D's. For a limited time, choose any two. From mouth-watering new picks to tasty classics. McPick 2 for $5. Enjoy the choice.
Rush hour or relax hour, it's your choice. Ride more, save more, do more. Dart, moving forward.
On 94.7 WDSD.
A fourth down run by Joe Carbone from 24 yards out makes the score 14-3 Stony Brook. That dash into the end zone by Joe Carbone, brought to you by Dash It. Nothing great was built on an empty stomach. Dash It now offers all new breakfast sandwiches on a warm buttery croissant roll. Try sausage egg and cheese, bacon egg and cheese, and double egg and cheese. Grab a 16 ounce Dash It coffee and a breakfast sandwich for only $3.50. Dash In, a proud sponsor of Delaware football. So the Hens can't catch a break. They had solid fourth down defense in this game prior to that one. After the kickoff, we'll send it down to Mike on the sideline and see what his thoughts were on the breakdown on that fourth down run by Carbone. High kick, and it's fielded by Malcolm Brown. And he takes it from the 32 to about the 39-yard line. So let's quickly send it down to the sideline. And Michael Atrasse, what happened on that last touchdown run by Carbone?
Guys, like we saw, there was a man blitz. Everyone is man-to-man on the outsides running with their receivers, and there's no one to account for the quarterback. That's when the DNs have to retrace. They can't just rush upfield and stay wide. They have to retrace and get their quarterback. Stony Brook's quarterback, he's shown that he can move. He's shown that he's willing to tuck the ball and run. So they have to not spy him, but just keep him in the pocket, if not retrace their pass rush and try to pick him up.
After this first down play, I'd love to hear from Mike. What are you seeing from the communication down there on the sideline with the new head coach?
We'll send it back as the first down run goes to Thomas Jefferson. Can't turn the corner, and he's brought down at the line of scrimmage. Mike, what's the communication been like down there on the sideline?
Guys, you can tell it's a little frantic. There's been substitution errors here and there. It's tough. You see interim coach Don Carter talking to the D-line, still coaching them up and still having to take his head coaching duties closer to the sideline. So there's a lot of back and forth. They're doing their best. You can see some of the players stepping up and getting people to the sidelines, communicating with the coaches. But it's been a little bit off in the first half.
It's got to be tough as the first game as interim head coach for Dennis Dotton Carter. Now we see a rollout by Joe Walker. Good pressure, as there has been most of the day when he drops back. Alan Singleton was there. He already has one sack and forced that pass low and incomplete for Delaware.
He's got to do a better job of pass protection. That's been one of the big issues for Delaware's offensive line since conference play began. We thought one of the strengths of this team, run blocking wise, they are, but pass protection wise, they have really struggled to give Walker opportunities to set his feet to throw the football. They've done a better job in that first half, but here on this drive, all kinds of traffic in the backfield near Walker's feet.
Delaware today on third down, 6 of 11. It's third down and 10 from their own 39, trips to the left side. Pressure coming. Walker dumps it to Tyler, who's going to be tackled for a loss back at the 36-yard line. And John Haggard, who's had a heck of a ball game, made the stop. We'll see Will Stevenson, the punter, for the second time today.
Well, they ran two vertical routes to try to run the safeties off. They're trying to get all the attention going to Hills as he went on a swing pattern to the left. Walker's supposed to look there, check back to Tyler. Give credit to the Stony Brook defense. Took away the vertical routes, but the linebackers stayed near Tyler and just gobbled him up.
Sherman Alston back to return for Stony Brook as Stevenson gets this one away, and it's a booming kick by Stevenson as Alston lets it bounce at the 12-yard line, and it skips right through the end zone. Stevenson showing off the legs. It's a 63-yard punt, but 43 net. And before Stony Brook comes back out on offense, we'll take a timeout. The Seawolves, 24th ranked team in the country, up 14-3, 8-16 third quarter. That's your PNC Bank timeout score.
Why choose Excel for your own?
They end 2015 with a road victory over Elon.
Our season ended at 255. At 256, a new season began. But we can't just talk about it. We've got to be about it. On the field, no one's spot is guaranteed. And in here, excuses don't matter. I'm going to work harder and longer than I ever have. Check your feelings at the door, because the bar has been raised.
Is the count. Stony Brook on top, the 24th ranked team in the country. Delaware trying to avoid their first five-game losing streak since starting the 1939 season. My goodness. Right now, down by 11.
Kevin Trezzolini was covering that team, wasn't he?
Kevin, fortunately for Matt, can't hear right now. He's on the opposite side of this booth. I'll get in the audio. First and 10 for Stony Brook. They'll start from their own 20-yard line. A rollout by Carbone. He's throwing on the run, and it's caught by Tim Keith, who slips with the help of Anthony Jackson at the 24-yard line. So pick up a four on first down to the six-year senior.
Dealt with some injuries. Got the extra year with the medical hardship waiver. Certainly an experienced guy, big, strong, physical guy. I'm a little surprised Stony Brook throw the ball as much as they are. I'd keep it on the ground right now, trust my defense, up by a couple of scores, and try to burn some clock and shorten this game.
Carbone, 5 of 11 today, 53 yards, and had that interception that you heard at the half by Malcolm Brown. In motion goes Cal Daniels from right to left, and Carbone will give it to the running back this time. Not much doing, and Bell is there. For the tackle for loss, perhaps they might give him back to the line of scrimmage. But Charles Bell has played phenomenally well this day so far, and he's been right in on a bunch of stops.
And Bell has really filled the holes effectively. Him and Reeder have worked great together today. I mean, Reeder forcing him back to the middle, Bell cleaning up, Bell getting penetration, forcing the play wide, and Reeder coming in to make stops. They have worked in great cohesion together.
Seven tackles for Reeder, six tackles for Bell. Now third down and five for Carbone out of shotgun, and they give it to Bedell, and he is done in the backfield. Bell again, back-to-back tackles by the middle linebacker, and Bedell that time stopped for a loss to punt team on.
Just shoots gaps. I mean, he is playing with reckless abandon, getting into the backfield, and now it's a big three and out for us because they got punted into the wind. The wind, we said, was calming down a little bit. Well, so much for that. It's picked back up. It is going to be tough to get much on the kick.
Remember, Vinny Papali injured with a knee injury. He's the normal punt return man. We haven't seen Troy Gallen, so Jamie Jarman is out there. Got to be careful into this win. If you don't think you can get under it, let it bounce. It's low. At the 50-yard line, it takes a hop. There will be no return. It takes a Stony Brook roll past the 40 down at about the 38-yard line. So Delaware will get the football back with 6:11 remaining after a 41-yard punt by Mark Nolan.
Boy, Adderley had a little contact there on the edge, but did a good job just to hold back and avoid a 15-yarder. And then that's where it hurts not having the guy who feels all that comfortable returning punts, because you'd like to see him shoot forward, come up and catch the football, but you can't risk turning it over. But you lost about 15 yards of rolling.
On the field, stadium scoreboard, they're showing Gino Kratkowski in the house, Super Bowl champion and former Delaware Blue Hen. Good to see him in the building. Hens with the football, first and 10 at their own 38-yard line. I form Kyle Yoakum is the fullback. Walker will go under center. And the running back is Hills. He is slammed to the turf by Tyrese Beverett, an All-CAA performer, and he'll be there again this year. An All-CAA performer thus far, that's for sure. We have a Newark Urgent Care injury stoppage as there's a man down at the 40-yard line for Delaware. And it's on the far side of the field, so we don't have eyes on it yet. It looks like Kyle Yoakum. Yoakum, the redshirt junior, former quarterback. He was the number four quarterback when he started his career back in 2013. Switched to tight end in 2014. You won't find any stats for Kyle Yoakum, but he is a big-time blocker, especially in those I-formation packages that he comes in to help with for these running backs. And he's down right now on the far side of the field at Newark Urgent Care injury break. And I'll remind our listeners that a portion of this game brought to you by Newark Urgent Care, Delaware's first and only 24/7 urgent care center. Newark Urgent Care is proud to support UD football and to have served the greater Newark and U of D community since 1973. When you need to see a doctor and don't have time for appointments, Newark Urgent Care's doctors will see you 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, and are located at 324 East Main Street. Convenient hours, convenient location on Main Street. And we appreciate all the support they've given to UD football broadcast on WDSD-FM. Through the years, visit newarkurgentcare.org.
Well, you feel for Yoakum right now as he is being looked at by the athletic training staff, and you're right, he has filled a lot of different roles for this Blue Hens team since he's gotten here, but kind of emblematic of this football team. Just, you know, whatever you need from the coaching staff, they step up and do that job, and that was one of the things, you know, the decision to dismiss head coach Dave Bratt made over the course of the week. You understand why it's made, and certainly that you look towards the future and some brighter times ahead in terms of the win-loss record. But the one thing you do have to give that man credit for, the way that he kind of got his players to buy into whatever, you know, he was trying to sell them. He needed him to slide to a role. They did it. They did it every single time. I mean, look, a guy like Jamie Jarman's played 3-4 different positions here. Yoakum's a guy that slid into some different spots and different roles, and it's just such an unselfish group. And I used to talk about all the time, you know, recruit the right type of kids. You want to build competition, you want to build depth, and you want to put guys that are buying into what you're trying to sell them and what you're trying to accomplish.
Cal Yoakum being helped off of the field as he used to walk from the Stony Brook sideline all the way over to the Delaware sideline. Quickly, let's get some scores around the CAA. A lot of action today.
Boy, Maine able to get the victory over Rhode Island. It's a big win for Maine. They've now taken 3 in a row, improving to 4-3 on the year, 3-1 for conference play. 28-21 win. It was a Josh Mack touchdown in the fourth quarter that got the Black Bears the win.
Josh Mack having a heck of a season against everybody but Delaware, and hence held him in check, the true freshman up there in Bangor. Second down and 7, and it's Wes Hills. Talk about bang. He banged into the defender at the 40-yard line. That tackle made by Noah McGinty, the middle linebacker. And Hens will have third down and about 7 to go.
Boy, they really done nothing with the wind at their back here in the third quarter. You were thinking getting the football. Interesting decision by Stony Brook to give Delaware the wind. And Hens needed to get something done in this third quarter. Stony Brook hoping to use the wind as a kind of a safety net in that fourth period, and it's gone the other way. Stony Brook has really controlled this third quarter thanks to turnover.
Wes Hills will be the running back next to Joe Walker in shotgun form on third down and 8. Delaware down by 11, 14-3, 5:06 third quarter, and Walker back to pass. Hills picks up the rusher at least momentarily. Walker held on to it for a long time and was dropped back at the 30-yard line. That's the third time Joe Walker has been sacked today. 4 sacks all season coming into this game, which ranked him 6th nationally. But a tough day so far for Joe Walker, and it's fourth down.
Like, again, they were trying to get the ball to Tyler underneath, and Tyler got knocked down and then maybe had a chance at a shot down the field with Amechi, but couldn't get him the football and just held it too long.
Alston back to return the punt. Stevenson got off a good one last time. Windu is back with 4:23 remaining and a whistle before the punt.
False start. Now it's unforced errors, and they're starting to do Delaware.
False start, number 7 of the offense, 5 yards, still fourth down.
And that's Ray Jones just trying to get a head start up the field on the outside. But you're right, unforced errors. If you're down by 11, 4:22 remaining in the third quarter, and the way this game has gone, not a high-scoring contest. You just can't afford to hurt yourself, as the Hens now do it.
Need a good punt here, try to flip the field.
Will Stevenson has punted 32 times this year, 41 yards on average, 18 of them fair caught. His last one went 63 yards but sailed into the end zone off of a bounce, netted 43. Stevenson with his feet at his own 12-yard line. Good snap from Sheridan. It's high, and it's another good one from Will Stevenson. Back to return it from the 21-yard line is Alston. Jackson slows him up momentarily, but he gets to the 30-yard line, and down he goes at the 36. It was a 53-yard punt by Will Stevenson, a 12-yard return, and Stony Brook will come out on offense once again with an 11-point lead, 3:53 in the third.
I mean, they haven't been able to get the field position after that first drive to start the second half at the 40. They didn't do much with that. The fumble really cost them in terms of changing field position. And I mean, you're expecting, at minimum, Stony Brook to start these drives from inside their own 20, inside their own 15. And instead, you know, you're out near midfield and feeling confident if you're the Seawolves.
Tight trips to the left side for Carbone on first and 10. It's a toss to Bedell. He's running at the 35, and he gets to the 40-yard line. Cam Kitchen was there. Sim Guashavano also in on the tackle. 3-yard pickup for Bedell, the captain.
Nice job by Guashavano that time, because he had a big tackle all over him. Paris, he sheds the block, stays wide to force the play back inside, and then after releasing from the block, got involved to the tackle. That's a heck of an effort by Sim Guashavano.
Simba, slow year statistically, 25 tackles, those two interceptions in back-to-back weeks a season ago, just 11 tackles and a pass breakup today for the this season for the redshirt senior. And now on second down, they give it to the back, and it's Bedell again. Bilal Nichols and Armin Ware combining for the stop. It'll be third down and short at the 44.
Remember, Ware forced that fumble in the end of the first half. Had a pretty big hit on the ball there, just couldn't find a way to pop it free. You could see what he was thinking, though.
We see Jason Thompson come into the game in the linebacker position. His brother is the captain, or one of the captains, on the Stony Brook team, Aaron Thompson. I haven't called his name. He's made only three tackles on the year, but a captain defensively. So a family rivalry going on within this CAA matchup. Third down and two, I form. The give is to Bedell, looking for space. There is none, and he is stuffed on third down. A nice job by the Delaware defense. Looked like Armin Ware from the defensive end position got in there quickly to slow down Bedell. And now the punt unit for Stony Brook on the field.
It's a good job by Ware because he gets penetration but doesn't collapse so much that it allows him to bounce it wide. He kept everything confined and contained into the center of the field. And that's a big stop. Big three and out for us by the Delaware defense again. One last chance to get something going with the wind at your back.
Armin Ware, what a pleasant surprise he's been this year. He's played very well.
The ball blew away from the center.
Ball rolling. It is still a windy day. It is not as windy as it was maybe at kickoff, but it is whipping here. The sun has come out, but it is whipping. And the ball rolled a little bit as the snapper Kevin Fennell didn't have his hands on it yet. Back to return, Jamie Jarman. And the punter, Mark Nolan, gets this one away. It's low. Wynn picks it up. It takes a Delaware hop from the 23 to about the 25-yard line. It's a 31-yard punt by Stony Brook. Let's send it down to Michael Atanasio, who's watching a defense that's looking pretty good over the last couple of possessions.
Guys, these guys are very excited. The energy is high on the sidelines. These guys are playing off of each other. One person makes a play, gets hyped, then the next person makes a play. I just want to see that hype and that energy transfer to the offense.
And remember, the defense, they've given up 7 points, and 7 points that was set up by a short field on a turnover. So they played a great game. The offense statistically was solid in the first half, but it's just done nothing here this third quarter.
Mike talked about energy. I got to talk about the crowd. There is no one here at this football game today. The energy is low as I can remember it at Delaware Stadium as Randolph starts this drive running to the left. Pushed down after a gain of one. It is as quiet as I can ever remember this day. You can hear the wind in our microphone, but that's about it. I was expecting more, I'll say, for a crowd to come out and hopefully support these guys after what's been a tough week.
Yeah, I mean, it's just been a tough year overall. I mean, people are deflated. I mean,
I agree with you.
They were expecting a playoff trip. They were expecting a good football team, and it's been a competitive football team, but it just hasn't been the season that they were hoping for. And it hasn't helped that, you know, it's 20 degrees cooler today than it has been for the last week and a half.
Second down and nine, approaching a minute remaining in the third quarter, and Jalen Randolph has a hole, gets the carry, gets to the 30-yard line. Tackle made by Noah McGinty and Usman Kamara combining for the stop. Quickly, it's third down and about four to go for Delaware, under a minute, third quarter.
I think the other thing that's hurt people a little bit today is they just haven't been able to cheer for.
That's true. It's been a low-scoring ball game with some turnovers.
And just, I mean, they forced a couple turnovers, and they got loud there at the end of the first half when they got that turnover, but then you get stopped on fourth and two, and it just deflated everything and just have had nothing going in the third quarter.
Trips to the right side for Walker as the team goes left to right down Tubby Raymond Field. Third down and five, they'll call it, from the 30. Randolph, a fumbled exchange. Stony Brook is there first. Who came up with the football out of the pile?
Looked like Walker thought he was handing it to Randolph. Randolph thought he was going to block.
No signal yet. Stony Brook indicating that they have the football, and they do. Another fumble lost.
Recovered by Stony Brook.
And it's Stony Brook football at the 29-yard line of the Hens with 22 seconds left in the third. If that fumbles on Jalen Randolph, it would be 24 straight games without a fumble snapped by Randolph. He went over 250 carries without fumbling the football And that one just on an exchange, a miscommunication between Walker and Randolph, as you mentioned.
That'll be interesting to see how they score that, because I didn't see Randolph really move his arms to take the football. He looked like he was just completing a fake, and Walker seemed to maybe have it knock off his side. I would put that fumble on Walker, but either way, I mean, it doesn't matter. It's a turnover, and it's another short field for Stony Brook.
I agree with you, Matt. They scored it as a fumble on Jalen Randolph for that 25-game streak. Snapped for Jalen. First down and 10, more importantly, for Stony Brook with great field position at the Hens 29 after another turnover. And Bedell trying to waste no time as he gets inside the 25. There is a flag on the play back at the 30-yard line, the line of scrimmage. Could be holding on Stony Brook.
The officiating
crew. Yeah, the officiating crew getting together, talking things over with 17 seconds left in the third and a 14-3 lead by the Seawolves, in good position to add to it.
I thought it was formation or a shift thing, because they had a lot of pre-snap movement and it just didn't look like they got everybody set again.
Illegal motion, number one of the offense, 5 yards, still first down.
They had two guys shifting and they were concentrating on trying to get set, because if you have two guys moving, you got to be set for a full second before the snap. And as they got set, then Keith tried to edge forward because he thought they didn't have enough on the line of scrimmage. And as he was edging forward, they snapped the football. It's like you can't be moving forward at the snap. So, you know, it's pick your poison. It's illegal formation. It's illegal motion. Either way, it's five against Stony Brook.
And the clock is going to run out on the third quarter of football. So 15 minutes left for the Hens to try to snap what is a four-game losing streak. Your PNC Bank timeout score, Stony Brook 14, Delaware 3.
This is Dr. Michael Axe at First Aid Surgery Center.
Little details. Truly a game of inches. Small things people don't see. It's about putting yourself in the best position. It starts here. The work isn't flashy. It's not glamorous, but it's necessary. Because after all, the future is now.
Hello.
Nice to meet you.
Welcome, welcome. Today I'm going to show you the all-new 2016 Chevy Cruze and ask you what you think. But here's the catch. You can only answer in emojis. What emoji would you use to describe the design?
I think it's sexy.
It has available built-in 4G LTE Wi-Fi.
Rock on, that's excellent. We got Wi-Fi.
This car gets an EPA estimated 40 miles per gallon highway.
This car is like a unicorn. It's magical.
At St. Francis Healthcare, they provide a higher level of care to better serve Blue Hens fans and the community. Did you know that at St. Francis, the average ER wait time is only 32 minutes? And if you're in an auto accident or suffer a fall, you can now go to St. Francis for high-level emergency care. Those are just some of the ways they are improving to better serve you. Learn more about the official hospital of Delaware Athletics at stfrancishealthcare.org. Well, 15 minutes remaining in this one. Fourth quarter of action about to start. Delaware down 14-3. The first game under interim head coach Dennis Dotton Carter, as Dave Brock was relieved of his duties, fired on Sunday after 3.5 seasons with the Hens. A short week of preparation in terms of they had to use Monday and Sunday to kind of figure out what was going on with the coaching situation. Got back to work on Tuesday, and it's been a tough week, but the Hens make it difficult on themselves today. They've had 6 fumbles, 4 of them lost. The most recent fumble gives Stony Brook the football at the Delaware 34-yard line, 1st and 15.
This is a very ugly third quarter. The teams combined for 61 yards of total offense. Delaware managed just 28 yards, and they turned the ball over a couple of times. Just can't have it.
Both Carbone in the game with Gowans, and the running back Sherman Alston runs wide to the right side. He's going to be pushed out by Ray Jones at around the 27-yard line. Stop by 7, Ray Jones. And it's going to be second down for Stony Brook.
And the clock is Stony Brook's friend at this point. Now the wind at their back, so it's going to make it even more difficult against the Delaware offense when they get it back. But right now, you're just hoping you can find a way to a stop. Remember, Stony Brook, no confidence in the kicker for field goals, so probably 4-down territory here.
Second down and 8, just underway here in the fourth. Delaware down 14-3. And Carbone will go under center, the fullback behind him. Play action. He turns, fires high, incomplete. At about the 10-yard line.
Joe Carbone's pass.
He has not been all that accurate.
He
today.
Has not. But this season he hasn't been. 52% of his passes completed on the year.
But it's just today he's had some high percentage throws that have just gone the wrong direction. I mean, that time that's a relatively easy pitch and catch, and he just couldn't find a way to hit his receiver. And that's the difference between probably a 4 or 5 yard gain and a third and short. Now third and long again, and Delaware has been blitzing often in this spot, but you've got to account for Carbone. He's hurt him with their left.
Donald Leontine in the game for the first time. He's the third string running back on third down and 8. They sent Alston in motion. Carbone hit down Jason Thompson, playing against his brother this afternoon with a huge third down sack.
A really well designed by the defensive staff that time. They showed middle blitz. Linebackers were standing up on the line of scrimmage, creeping forward. So they shifted and kind of shelled their protection towards the center of the field. Thompson came off the edge and pretty much came untouched. It was all over Carbone. You turn it into a punt. Wow.
Third sack of the season for Thompson. Out of 10 total tackles, 3 of them for sacks. A good season for the sophomore from Deer Park, New York. And now the punt unit on. Jamie Jarman back to return. This defense has played well today, that's for sure. Directional kick as they try to get it to the side of the field. Do so. It bounces at the 1 into the end zone. It goes for a touchback. It'll net just 16 yards as that one from the 36, and the Hens will come and bring it out of the end zone.
Defense doesn't stop, and we've said that a lot. Now the offense has got to kind of carry its own weight. It was effective with some balance of the first half, but Stony Brook has adjusted, and the pressure is just killing. 5 sacks, 13 tackles for a loss so far in this game for Stony Brook. That's a really high total in 46 and a half minutes of football.
Now, before this game, Wes Hills had not been tackled behind the line of scrimmage. It's a hard thing to do. He's lost 7 yards, part of that tackle for loss marked by Stony Brook. It's been impressive, that's for sure, on a defense that's third in the CAA in total yards, but today holding Delaware just 159 total yards as the offense back on the field for Delaware. 13-34, fourth quarter, their first possession in the fourth quarter, and a pass is thrown wide to Chichi Amachi by Joe Walker to start the drive. Incomplete.
Smaller window that time for Joe. You know, he had some open targets. I'm not sure if Stony Brook has adjusted here defensively to take the seam away or if Delaware's kind of gone away from it on their own, but they had some success center of the field. Scarth, and I think it was Owen Tyler, they hit a couple of times over the middle in that first half, but I give credit to Stony Brook. They saw it, adjusted to it, and have taken it away.
Whaley is the tight end. Offset eye on second down and 10. And it's going to be Wes Hills contact at the line of scrimmage, but as he does, he finds a way to absorb it and gain a few yards. He gets 5 on second down and 10.
Still doesn't quite look 100%, though, does he? The way he kind of bounced up there, looks like he's favoring that arm, elbow a little bit. Rubbing it right now as he stands in a Delaware huddle. I mean, it really is amazing. He was able to come back as quickly as he did from what looked like is an incredibly painful injury in the game at Lafayette.
Yeah, that elbow injury against Lafayette. He had a lower body injury a couple weeks back, missing last week. Now third down and 5. It's Hills that stands next to Walker. He'll go in motion. And Walker running an option play. Chichi Amachi was held up, and they blow it dead as that's a passing play incomplete on the flip. It was Shane Lawless who was all over Amachi. He could not hold on to it.
Again, another linebacker diagnosing it, and they tried to hide Amachi as he stayed low, breaking the huddle. It almost looked like he was trying to hide behind the right tackle and had the defense lose track of him. They tried to bluff. Again, the swing pass to Hills on the outside, and then across the grain, sneak the shovel pass back, but it was diagnosed immediately by Lawless.
So a 3 and out for Delaware. 4th down for Will Stevenson. This one perhaps getting caught in the wind. It's out of bounds. That's not a good punt from Will Stevenson, who's been very successful thus far this season. So Stony Brook going to have very good field position.
At the 48-yard line.
48-yard line. Just a 23-yard punt by Will Stevenson. That'll bring us to a timeout. With 12:39 remaining in the fourth, 14-3, Stony Brook. That's your PNC Bank timeout score.
Churrascaria Saudades, more than a restaurant. We are.
Want more Delaware Athletics content? Click around here on Hens All Access for live games, game highlights, features, and more. And follow your favorite Hens on Twitter for the latest updates.
It's your turn to mix it up at Mickey D's. For a limited time, choose any two. From mouth-watering new picks to tasty classics. McPick 2 for $5. Enjoy the choice.
Rush hour or relax hour, it's your choice. Ride more, save more, do more. Dart, moving forward.
...94.7 WDSD.
Welcome back to Delaware Stadium. Scott Klatskin alongside Matt Janis, Michael Attanarase down on the field. You know, I mentioned a smaller crowd today, and it is windy, cold conditions, and it has not been very loud here at Delaware Stadium, but you got to give the fans something to cheer for. There has been nothing for Delaware, and now a three and out. They punt it away in good field position again for Stony Brook. I should say nothing on offense to cheer about. The defense has been very good in this game.
Defense has given up 32 yards in the second half, and you've been outscored 7-0. I mean, if that doesn't sum it up, I don't know what will.
There has been nothing doing for Delaware offensively. Just 164 total yards in this game. Full house with Carbone to start this drive. They'll give it to Stacy Bettle, and he's got some speed at the 45 down in Delaware territory at the 41. Pickup of 7 on first down, and now it's second and short.
I mean, the problem here you run into if you're the Hens, got to keep them out of the end zone. If they score a touchdown, game's over. But the field is so flipped against you. I mean, you're just playing like you're running uphill 10 on a treadmill. I mean, you're stuck on your own side of the field. Maybe a turnover is really the only way you can get this turned around at this point.
There's been plenty of them today. Four fumbles lost by Delaware. Second down and 3. Metal stopped by Bell. He has been phenomenal today.
Boy, he just has picked every gap right. And give credit to the line in front of him. You know, the linebackers can be more effective when the D-line is kind of getting in the blocker's way. That's your job. Hold your ground and absorb bodies and then let the linebackers come in, fill holes, and make plays. And Bilal Nichols, he occupied two offensive linemen that time, and that allows Bell to come forward and get the stop in the backfield.
Third down and 4 for Stony Brook, 11-28, fourth quarter. They lead by 11. Bedell is the running back next to Carbone in shotgun, 2 wide receivers to the left. That's the way he's looking, checks down, finds Keith in the middle of the field. He's running for a first down and more. 30, 25, out of bounds at the 20-yard line for Keith, the 6-year man. A 22-yard gain on third down, and now in the red zone once again are the Seawolves.
Shallow crosses have just killed Delaware today. Bell got caught a little flat center of the field. I'm not sure if he just did not see Keith coming across his direction or what it was, but that little too easy, kind of alarmingly easy that time on third down.
Tim Keith has had another play like that earlier. Third catch of the day, 55 yards for Keith. And now first down and 10 from the red zone out to 20. Carbone under center. Bedell is the running back. He's looking for a hole. There isn't one to the left, so he bounces it to the right. And Bedell running for the end zone at the 10-5, picks up a block and scores. Bounced it after it looked like there was nothing doing, and ends up with a touchdown run of 20 yards.
Just nobody there on the backside for Delaware. They really had it corralled, but you got to go make the tackle and give Bedell credit. Instead of just jamming it up there, just kept his feet, kept his vision, saw nobody left on that backside, gave a little bit of ground, and then turned on the speed and beat everybody to the far pylon.
First touchdown of the day for Stacy Bettle. Second rushing touchdown of the afternoon for Stony Brook, and the extra point is through, making it 21-3 with 10:41 left in the fourth. That's your PNC Bank timeout score as Stony Brook leads.
St. Francis Healthcare.
Welcome. How are you doing?
Thanks for coming. Today you're going to choose a mobile office to drive to a remote work site.
Okay.
You can choose this Chevy Silverado that offers built-in 4G LTE Wi-Fi, or you can choose this Ford F-150 that doesn't offer Wi-Fi. But to make up for it, we added a trailer, a satellite antenna, and Dolores.
Hey, fellas.
Technology's a little behind in here.
Now, the Silverado offers built-in Wi-Fi with a connection that's stronger than your smartphone.
Slick.
So which one do you want?
I'd pick the Chevy.
Silverado.
It leaves Ford in the dust.
It just can't beat it.
And a goal! It's Delgado with his second.
Country 94.7 WDSD.
A 20-yard run by Stacy Bettle makes it 21-3. Stony Brook on top in a sky kick. And Adderley will take it to 10, to the 20-yard line, and he gets contact, and down he goes at the 30-yard line. This is just disheartening. Delaware fans, you know, it's been a tough week, like we said. I didn't think I'd see this today. 21-3, 10:36 remaining in the fourth, and nothing shown offensively. And the defense now allowing what ended up being a walk-in touchdown by Stacy Bettle after he made a nice move going left to right.
The thing is, it's not a lack of effort. It's not a lack of energy. It's not a lack of excitement down there on the field. They've just been outplayed. I mean, Stony Brook is a big, physical, talented defense, but they shouldn't be manhandling you up front the way they are right now. They're just physically have been superior right now up front over the course of really most of the game, but especially the second half. They have dominated up front.
See if Delaware can put anything together, because we have not seen it in the second half offensively. In a game that started off well for Delaware on the offensive side, this drive starts at their own 31, and again Noah McGinty, the middle linebacker, making the stop. Perhaps another tackle for loss. If it is second and 11, then that'll be tackle for loss number 14 on the day from Stony Brook. They'll get him back to line of scrimmage, though, second and 10.
He's just running against a stacked deck. I mean, the linebackers are up the field. They're almost playing their outside linebacker like he's a fifth defensive lineman right now. And there's just nowhere to go wide. And then up the middle, they're getting pushed around.
Walker in shotgun form on second down and 10. 5 minutes into the fourth quarter. Sets his feet, throws to Chichi Amachi, who bobbles it, and incomplete it falls. Chichi Amachi, a good chance to get his first career catch at around the 40-yard line, but he let it slip through his hands and fall incomplete.
Perfect throw by Walker. It's an easy 7-8 yard gain. And Amachi just wanted to get up the field. He was trying to do too much there and started to go before he secured the catch.
Second target of the day for Chichi Amachi, playing more snaps at least for the suspended Deontay Cherry, suspended for an internal team matter. Vinny Papali also injured with a knee injury, so they're short on wide receivers, but certainly a catchable ball and a very good toss by Joe Walker. Now third down and 10 from the 31. Screen pass is incomplete. They tried to dump it off to Thomas Jefferson. In his area was Usman Kamara, and now another third down incompletion and another three and out for Delaware offensively. This has just been poor. This has been hard to watch at times today, and that being
on a punt for Delaware,
part of it.
Stevenson.
9:51 remaining in the fourth quarter of action. Stony Brook up 21-3, and they're going to get the ball back with solid field position. Will Stevenson will punt it away. Sherman Alston is the return man, the junior. He awaits the kick. Stevenson's last one just went 22 yards. This one gets caught in the wind. At the 45, takes a Delaware hop to the 40, and it's rolling now down to the 38-yard line. It's going to be down by Casey Hinton. That's a 31-yard punt by Will Stevenson. We'll take a timeout with 9:38 remaining. Your PNC Bank timeout score, Stony Brook 21, Delaware 3.
Rodin Protection.
They end 2015 with a road victory over Elon.
Our season ended at 2:55. At 2:56, a new season began. But we can't just talk about it. We've got to be about it. On the field, no one's spot is guaranteed. And in here, excuses don't matter. I'm going to work harder and longer than I ever have. Check your feelings at the door, because the bar has been raised.
WDSD and iHeartRadio.
Fuddruckers, home of the world's greatest hamburgers, is located right off of Churchman's Road on Jeffrey Drive in Newark. Check out their Blue Hens Radio Burger of the Week, the Bourbon Burger, with sweet bourbon sauce, smokehouse bacon, bourbon, caramelized onions, and crumbled blue cheese. And remember, be one of the first to send us a picture of you eating in the Blue Hens booth at Fuddruckers. We'll give you a $25 gift card for your next visit. Send to UDFootball@WDSD.com. That's Fuddruckers in Newark off of Churchman's Road. Delaware back out there on defense, and that's where they've looked solid. Delaware on offense has been very difficult to watch, especially in this second half, Matt.
You guys actually read the wrong column. Delaware has 4 yards of total offense since halftime. It just nothing has gone right. Give Stony Brook's defense credit. They adjusted and have dominated.
Seawolves with the football up 21-3. They'll start at their own 38-yard line. Gowans is the running back. He runs into Armin Ware, who came over from left defensive end spot to tackle him on the left side of the field, and it'll be second down and 10.
Watch Sean Devine right now over there working. He's offensive coordinator, also offensive line coach for this Delaware team. But there's no yelling, or it's almost half therapist right now, just trying to keep this team that's been through so much really all season, but especially this week, trying to keep them engaged mentally, trying to keep them up and just find something here down the stretch. Because remember, we still have 4 football games remaining after this one.
Supposed to be therapeutic to get out there on the field this week, but this is, I'm sure, not helped the beaten down squad right now, as Gowans will burst through the middle of the field, found a hole, ran into Ryan Torza at the 43-yard line. It'll be third down for Stony Brook. Stony Brook 3 of 10 today on third down. Delaware's defense has been solid, as we've mentioned.
And remember, I mean, you get one next week where you have a real shot. Towson has struggled. They're 1-6 on the season, but 1-5 on the season entering this game today with New Hampshire. Probably will be 1-6 entering that game next week. But after that, I mean, it's playoff teams the rest of the way. Albany, Villanova, and Richmond. There's not a lot of W's left on the schedule, or at least easy W's.
Richmond number 2 in the nation earlier this year before they lost to this Stony Brook team. Now we're at 24th. In the country. On third down and 5, they gave it to the running back Gowans, and he was tackled for a loss. A bunch of blue jerseys there. Reeder was there. Woodson as well. John Nassib with a good push. So again, Delaware stops Stony Brook on third down. The Seawolves now 3 of 11 on third downs today, and Delaware's offense will be back on the field, and they have a chance to add on to just their 4 yards total of offense in the second half on offense.
Give Delaware's defense credit, though, man. They
absolutely
have not quit despite getting handed nothing but short fields. They did miss a tackle and give up a touchdown on the previous drive, but that's it. I mean, one defensive touchdown, one short field, and then another less than 50-yard drive. Give it up.
Mark Nolan gets off a good one. High bounce for Jarman. Far side of the field. Fielded at the 8-yard line. Good pursuit by Stony Brook to stop him in his tracks. A 47-yard punt by Mark Nolan. Nothing on the return for Jamie Jarman, who's back there replacing Vinny Papali, who is injured. This, perhaps for the season, out indefinitely with a knee injury, is Papali.
If I'd have told you in this game, I know Stony Brook's not a big pass team. They're a run-first team, too. But if I'd have told you Delaware's plus 16 through the air, you'd have liked the Hens' chances today. You'd have said, wow, okay. And then that either means they're playing incredible defense or they're a little balanced and maybe moving the ball and getting some points. And that's exactly where we are. And they are playing incredible defense. But they just, I mean, it's just unbelievable what Stony Brook's front has done to shut down this Delaware running attack.
The Hens will begin this drive on their own 9-yard line, and Walker will keep it. Cuts it as he started left, changed direction and got to the 11-yard line. But again, just a good push, good pursuit by the defensive line of Stony Brook. A player is down. It's Humphrey Anu, the junior from Columbia, Maryland. Newark Urgent Care injury break as they look at him. With 7:06 remaining in this contest, this is just not what you expected from Delaware to come out with in this game. I thought there would be more energy. I thought there would be, I thought they would come out after what was a tough week, Dave Brock being fired on Sunday, and just play much better than this. Obviously, it's hard to do that, but I thought this would kind of take their mind off of things, and it's been difficult today offensively. They started off so well offensively. The only reason they didn't score on the opening drives because they were moving down the field was these turnovers. They got on the board with a field goal in the first half, and we've seen nothing in the second half. It's been disheartening here at Delaware Stadium today. 7:06 remaining.
Yeah, Stony Brook went into the locker room, and they adjusted to what Delaware was trying to do. And, I mean, the killer was the inability to get points at the end of the first half. We were given the gift on the fumble. And then you get a short kick, good field position at your own 40. You're thinking, okay, you can get it back. You're only down by four. Put together a drive here. Don't need that much with the wind at your back. And you turn it over, and it turns into points almost immediately for Stony Brook. The Hens were just never able to recover from that point forward. But it has been those mistakes that kind of getting in your own way that has stopped any momentum from getting going. And Stony Brook's a good football team. I mean, they're a top 25 team in the country. When you're shooting yourself in the foot the way the Hens have today, it's just going to be tough to get much done. And they have certainly not gotten anything done in the second half.
As they look at Humphrey Anu down there on the field, still resting and being checked on at the 10-yard line. I want to thank Unique Impressions. We're proud to sponsor or to be partners with Unique Impressions. Custom screen printing, logo embroidery, and promo products for your company or organization located on Main Street in Newark. And we appreciate the gear and embroidery work that they're doing with WDSD this season. Also, the company that is trusted with the sideline gear and work from the University of Delaware Athletics. So a big thanks to Unique Impressions. Visit uniqueonline.com. And Anu, unfortunately for him, it looks like that's an injury that certainly going to take him out of this game. But the way it looks, he's not looking good as he needs help getting to the sideline, limping over. So our thoughts are with Humphrey Anu, the linebacker for Stony Brook. 6:58 remaining and ticking now. Randolph is the running back. Walker in shotgun form. Two wide receivers to the left. Walker going to look that way. Throwing. Amachi gets another chance. Catches this one at the 20-yard line and falls backwards to the 22. And a first down pickup for Chichi Amachi, the first career catch from the true freshman from William Penn.
And good for him. He was down on himself after being unable to catch that ball on the previous drive. And Walker goes right back to him.
Walker throwing to Jarman on the opposite side of the field. He cuts it at the 30-yard line and contact by Tyrese Beverett. Stops him at the 31. So Delaware showing some movement on back-to-back plays offensively.
You know, the Hens need this. Even if it does nothing in this game right now, just for their own confidence sake on the offensive side. Softer coverage, throw the ball, get some yardage here.
Third catch of the day for Jamie Jarman, thrown now behind Owen Tyler on second down and one. It'll be third down and one for the 31 of Delaware. 6:13 remaining in this one. The Hens trail 21-3. Just trying, like you said, to show something offensively to take in the next week against Towson. A very winnable football game, or at least the best shot you'll have probably the rest of the season, playing ranked and playoff contenders the rest of the way.
Well, that's the thing, though, that Joe Walker's got to get out of his game there, the erratic nature of it. He's so accurate for three or four balls, and then one just completely comes out of his hand wrong. He missed that throw by 3-4 yards.
Third down and one for Delaware. Walker keeps it himself, and I think he got enough. Ball came loose. Stony Brook yelling as if they have the football. If that counts as a fumble, it's the seventh of the game for Delaware.
They definitely have it. Just was it out before he came down?
Stony Brook with the football. No signal yet as to if it was a fumble. The officials talking it over. Stony Brook with the ball, and it'll be official. The fifth fumble lost in this game by the Blue Hens.
I think four of them belong to Joe Walker now, too.
Fumble recovery.
And I'm sure they'll review that.
The previous play of a fumble to recovery is under further review.
I'd be lying if I said I saw the ball pop out. There was just too much traffic center of the field. It was an odd play. Took a step back from center and then charged forward and was able to run two or three steps before any contact came. And then as he was going down, I thought he was on the ground, but you couldn't see if he still had possession when he got to the ground. Every Stony Brook player jumped to the side of the pile. They put it up on the big screen here as Walker goes forward, and that view is not going to be conclusive. The ball does come out, but you can't see where his knee was when it did.
The view they're showing at Delaware Stadium from behind the play. There's a lot of blue and white jerseys in the area. One of the reasons we didn't get a view of the ball coming out was because of the pile on a QB keep on third down and one. So a lot of players are going to be in the area on a QB sneak anyway. Ball did come loose. If it is a fumble, it's a fifth fumble lost by Delaware, the seventh fumble of the game, as Wes Hills popped two loose. Owen Tyler recovered a Wes Hills fumble earlier in the game, and Joe Walker got a fumble back earlier in the half before giving it up again to Stony Brook.
You know, the thing that makes you think, though, probably was a fumble was the reaction of Walker. Maybe he's just frustrated and it came over the top, but there was no point to the ground or anything like that. There was just kind of resignation to it as he got up and walked back towards the sideline. You do feel for Walker. He's taking a heck of a beating today, but he's got to find a way to put the football away. Can't have it keep going to the carpet the way it has, especially with the regularity it has in, over the course of this afternoon.
Michael Atanase is on the sideline. Maybe he got a better view.
After further review, the call in the field stands. Stony Brook's ball, first and 10.
So it is Stony Brook's ball. I do want to get down to Michael Atanase. What did you see on that play, Mike?
Guys, I saw exactly what you said, Matt. As soon as Walker got up, you could see language from his body, and I don't think that helped in the ref's call at all. It's just a shame that these guys are putting the ball on the field so much. I haven't seen a seven fumble game from a team in my experience. This is something else.
Yeah, it's been a rocky one, to say the least, here at Delaware Stadium. Seven fumbles, five lost. As Stony Brook's offense on the field, they'll start at the Delaware 33-yard line with Carbone under center. The give is to Stacey Bettle, the running back running left, and Bilal Nichols there first. A lot of blue jerseys in on the tackle as he got back to the line of scrimmage. Clock ticking just under 6 minutes. 5:55, 21-3. Stony Brook, and the score doesn't even tell the whole story of this game.
I mean, 4 yards in offense until that last drive for Delaware. They did manage a first down, but you're still under 20 for the second half. And the giveaways, the sloppy nature of the game. Again, a group of young men that dealt with a lot this week. That's a lot to process, but you were hoping for a little more than this. It just hasn't been their day.
Stacey Bettle is a single back on second down and 10. And he'll get the carry again to the left side. Sprinting down the sideline past Delaware defenders and into the end zone. A 33-yard touchdown run by Stacey Bettle, his second of the afternoon.
Well, the ends all day long have done a great job denying those outside runs, setting the edge, forcing them back inside. But it looked like Malcolm Brown and Troy Reeder both took poor angles, got stuck inside. And that kid is an electric back, but that was one of the best in the CAA. And he had been contained most of the afternoon, but a couple of breakdowns, and he's bounced plays wide and run for some long ones in the second half.
33-yard run that time. He had a 50-yard run earlier, a 20-yard touchdown. He's up to 120 yards, and the extra point is good. And now this score kind of tells the story. 28-3, a dominant performance by Stony Brook. 5:15 remaining in this game. Stacey Bettle, what a day. A week ago, he had 138 yards on 26 carries. This week, 120 on 14 carries. And they made quick work of that possession after the turnover. Two plays, 33 yards, two carries by Bettle. And the Hens trail now by 25 points with 5:15 remaining. We'll stay right here.
Just jarring this second half. It's a football team that there's just something missing. You know what I mean? There are talented football players on this team, and you can see it, but you know, sometimes you have ingredients, but you don't have the full repertoire you need to make a dish. It, just seems like you don't have that full repertoire needed to get the end result that you were looking for. Just little things getting in their own way and just not enough firepower offensively. And it's a good defense, but it's not the overwhelming great defense that you need to be able to overcome a non-existent offense.
Ball falls off the tee. Wind still blowing here at Delaware Stadium. And, of course, the talent that we expected the defense to have this season, part of the reason that Dave Brock was relieved of his duties, because this talent that at least we thought we had, that we were pitched that we had, has not been the case this season. We haven't seen it come to fruition for whatever the reason may be. As you said, one reason or another, it just has not come into place. And a 33-yard touchdown run by Stacey Bettle makes it 28-3. Adderley will field it in the end zone on the kickoff return. It'll be a touchback. Delaware back out there on offense, 5:15 remaining, and that time can't go fast enough for these Hens today. A lot of action in the CAA today, as all the games for CAA teams, no non-conference play, all CAA contests, and Maine got a victory over Rhode Island earlier.
Yeah, they won by 7, so they've rolled off 3 wins in a row. Villanova's going right down the field on their first possession against Albany. They're at the Great Dane 7-yard line. Two teams that Delaware still has left to play, Albany and Villanova, both right amongst the top 25 in the FCS playoff field. That's a big one. So far, it's been all Nova.
Trips to the right side as Delaware starts this drive on their own 25. A sprint out for Walker. He's slowed up, has to change direction. He's going to run with the football, and down he goes at the 30-yard line. Great effort by Joe Walker to move the football up the field, a 5-yard pickup by Joe. And there's another player down for Stony Brook back at the 26.
And again, the one thing you don't want to focus on is these kids. They are, it's not a lack of effort. It's not, there's a lack of energy right now, obviously, so down 25 with 5 minutes to go in the fourth quarter. But I did think there was in the first half. It's just a lack of execution. But give Walker a whole lot of credit for that play. But that's a lot of effort expended to get 5 yards. And that's the concern, that, he's sprinting, having to break 3 tackles, change direction 2 different times. And all that movement, you think, well, that's a decent run, and then you look, and it's 5-yard gain. It's just too tough right now for Delaware on the offensive side. Their offensive line is struggling, and I think that is what they have to figure out a way to get fixed, because you came into the season thinking that was going to be one of the great strengths of this football team, and they've been solid until today, run blocking, and really struggled in pass protection. Today they've just struggled across the board. The pass protection has been virtually non-existent, and they have not run the ball at all in the second half.
Yeah, we've seen, and Walker got away from a sack that time, but we've seen more sacks today than we had in the first 6 games of the season, when Delaware was ranked first in the CAA in sacks allowed with 4, and Walker sacked 4 times today alone. So you're right about the offensive line, at least in today's ball game. The injured player, Odine Gilzine, the redshirt freshman from New York, and he gets up, walking to the sideline under his own power. That was a Newark urgent care injury break. As he gets off the field, Delaware's offense comes back on. Second down and 5 from the Delaware 30-yard line, and Delaware down 28-3 here in the fourth, under 5 minutes to play.
Stony Brook closing in on a playoff break now, up to 5-2. 3 to clinch it, 2 away, but they've had a lot of injuries today, especially on the defensive side.
Walker will drop back, pumping, throwing a dart to Brandon Whaley at the 35-yard line. That's a drop by Brandon Whaley. But Joe Walker's got to show a little bit more touch. He zoomed that right into the hands of Whaley. And again, hits her hands should be caught, but we just haven't seen that touch from Joe Walker.
Yeah, he just seems to, he has one speed.
Yeah.
I mean, he throws everything.
All fastballs.
Full speed, but I do agree. I mean, Whaley, he'll tell you, he's got to find a way to catch it. Got on him faster than he was anticipating, but he's got to catch it. He wasn't even trying to run before he had it, just didn't get the hands closed on it in time.
Third, maybe fourth drop of the day for Delaware. Now third down and 5. Walker dancing, throwing, has Scarf. It's caught as he falls at the 31-yard line. The biggest pickup through the air today. Joe Walker to the tight end, Charles Scarf, for 39 yards.
Probably should have been a touchdown. Give Walker credit, though. Had to climb the pocket. Had to elude a little bit of rush. Get Scarf.
Now Walker again looking to pass. Has some time. Dumps it to Randolph. Catches at the 26. Down he goes at the 25-yard line. And the tackle made by Deshaun Tucker, the linebacker, at second down. Hens going fast. Randolph is the running back. From the 26, Walker on the out route. Passing it wide to Jarman, who couldn't haul it in. Perhaps another drop for Delaware as it hit his hands in pursuit. On the play was Tadarian Luster.
Kind of an odd route there. Not sharp enough from Gainey, who's still, I think, learning the intricacies of playing wide receiver. And he's a much stronger route runner this year than he was in his first season a year ago. But it just kind of a too shallow of a route there. And Walker is expecting him to get further to the sideline.
Stony Brook just changed their entire defense as Randolph gets the give on third down and four. He's going to be stopped for maybe a yard. Tackle made by Jaheim Woods, the player that originally picked up the fumble and scoop and scored the wrong direction for Delaware. He's the team's leader on defense, and he made a nice stop there. It's fourth down for Delaware, 3:48 remaining, and the Hens offense obviously going to stay on for fourth down.
He literally put 11 new guys into the game. Did he put backups in and then decide that he wanted to keep Delaware out of the end? That was about as odd a thing as I've seen.
Everybody came off for Stony Brook, and they still were able to hold Delaware to a yard on third down. Fourth and four from the Stony Brook 25-yard line after a big pass of 39 yards from Walker to Scarf got him there. Walker stepping up in the pocket, throwing behind Amachi, who gets hit hard as the ball whizzes past him. An incomplete pass and a turnover on downs at Stony Brook football.
Turnover on downs. That kind of sums up the day for Delaware. I thought Walker had the opportunity to run and pick that first down up. He did step forward. He's been kind of hanging backside of the pocket a little too much, but didn't get his feet set, didn't get his shoulders turned on that throw, and that's what leaves it behind their target.
And first and 10, Seawolves.
Man, just frustrating day. Stony Brook a chance to run the clock out now.
It's the fifth target of the day for Chichi Amachi, only one of them caught for 11 yards. Walker, 12 of 26, 134 yards. No touchdowns, no interceptions. And now with 3:17 remaining, Stony Brook going to keep it on the ground a bunch as they do on first down from their own 25. It was the third string running back, Donald Leotine. Just 11 carries on the season before today. That's his second on the day-to-day against Delaware.
Well, if you're Delaware, know you have homecoming next week. That's something to kind of look towards. You have Towson coming in. It's a team that has struggled. It's amazing. I mean, these two programs that were kind of humming there in 2007, 2010, Towson into the national championship game in 2013, and they have just fallen on rock-bottom hard times.
Carbone will give it to Leotine again. Burst of speed. He broke one as he got to the 34-yard line. And it's going to be third down at about a yard for Stony Brook as he showed some power on that run.
And if I'd have told you 3 years ago that Towson and Delaware were going to square off homecoming at Delaware Stadium in late October and they were going to have a combined 3 wins, you'd have said I was nuts. Heck, if I'd have told you that 6 weeks ago, you'd have told me I was nuts. But that's the way, unfortunately, the season has unfolded for both of these clubs.
Yeah, both squads struggling, to say the least. It'll be just a game that Delaware's looking forward to. Getting rid of this one and heading on to homecoming, because this one is not one to remember today at Delaware Stadium. On third down and a yard, Leotine breaks to the outside. Tenny and Awusi pushes him out, or I should say Leotine pushes Tenny and Awusi to the ground as he steps out of bounds. And a first down pickup for Stony Brook. A minute 45 remaining until this one is official. Stony Brook, the 24th ranked team in the country, will improve to 5-2 on the season, 4-0 in conference play. Delaware was looking to pick up their 150th win in the CAA, which used to be the Yankee Conference in the Atlantic 10, but they'll have to wait till next week, possibly, against Towson. Stony Brook, though, their best season thus far in conference competition. This is a team that is a solid ball club as Leotine gets it on first down and 10 and runs strong to the 46.
How weird is it, Scott, that you're playing a conference with a team as many years as Delaware and Stony Brook have been together here over the last handful, and this is the first matchup. Just an odd quirk of the schedule. You understand, in an unbalanced schedule, they're going to play everybody every year, but to go several seasons without squaring off.
Yeah, year four. It's odd. Absolutely right. A minute 15, and they'll go victory formation for Stony Brook.
Although the way this one went today, maybe you might not mind it being four more.
These two teams have never met, like you said, Not in non-conference play in previous years. Not in conference play or the first 4 years. Carbone going to take the snap and take a knee. We'll have to do that one more time with 57 seconds remaining. This is a day to forget. Difficult week as the decision was made on Sunday to relieve Dave Brock of his coaching duties after 3.5 seasons. Dennis Dotton Carter, his first game as interim head coach. And the Hens will lose this one 28-3. On their home field, not scoring a touchdown at Delaware Stadium. And we'll talk with head coach Dennis Dotton Carter. Matt, we'll have some questions for him after the ball game, so you want to hear that. One more knee from Stony Brook, and it'll be official. Carbone under center, and that'll do it for this ball game. Delaware under interim head coach Dennis Dotton Carter for the first time falls 28-3 at Delaware Stadium. Tough one to say the least as Delaware gets 238 total yards of offense, 104 on the ground, 134 through the air. And Stony Brook just had their number in the second half of football. Delaware falls to 2-5 on the season, their first five-game losing streak since starting the 1939 season. The 1939 season, they had seven losses to start the year in 1939, but it has been a long, long time since we've seen a Delaware season like this. Five straight losses. They were 2-0. They are now 2-5, 0-4 in conference play, 1-2 at home, 1-3 on the road. Stony Brook now 2-1 on the road, 5-2 overall, and an impressive 4-0 in a tough CAA conference, including a win over Richmond earlier in the year. And of course, today's win 28-3. Matt, tough one.